this road to rediscover. Hey, sister, know the water's sweet, but blood is thicker. Oh, if the sky comes falling down for you, there's nothing in this world I wouldn't do.
Ladies and gentlemen, colleagues and friends, take your seat. Trauma critical care, acute care surgery 2019 is now in order. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce someone to you that's been responsible for several years for all the things that happened good at Caesar's Palace, and that's Gary Selesner, the president and CEO of Caesar's Palace, and he is here to greet you. Mr. Selesner.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Good morning. How are you today? Well, as regional president of of Caesar's Palace and about four others of our properties here on the Strip. I'm so pleased to welcome you to the Trauma, Critical Care, and Acute Care Surgery Conference, affectionately known by many of you, I think, as the Maddox Trauma Course. And I think in part that's because Dr. Maddox has been involved with this for all these years, and the conference, remarkably so, has been, this is its 52nd year in a row in Las Vegas at Caesar's Palace. Think about that for a second. That makes it, in some ways, the longest running show at the same venue in Las Vegas. Actually, longer than Frank Sinatra, Elvis, and Celine's runs here at Caesar's Palace, if you combined them all. So that's pretty remarkable. And then over the years, I've gotten to know some of you, and you have expressed to me that this conference, which is organized, of course, by Dr. Maddox and the one and only Mary Ellen, have actually orchestrated a discipline and fun learning experience and have done so now between the two of them for 30 years. So I think that deserves a hand as well. There's no question that this is the largest and most popular trauma course in the entire world. The faculty is recognized around the world for their expertise and as the best educators in the business, the best of the best, in fact. And in the gaming business, we call that a winning hand, and that's true for all of you here today. It's a sure thing. I also know that many of you were out taking photos in front of the famous fountains at Caesar's Palace, and you may be aware of the ice skating events and even the motorcycle jumps that have taken place out there, including the famous one by Evel Knievel long ago. And I want you to know that those fountains are very close to our heart and many people in the community. And so about 6 or 7 years ago, we decided to take all the coins that people throw into those fountains, and it's thousands and thousands of dollars a year, and donate it on behalf of the UMC Trauma and Burn Center here in Las Vegas. We also host, actually right in this room, their annual Survivors Luncheon, at which some of the patients who suffered terrific, horrific accidents, and of course the doctors and nurses who are there to save them in many cases and to care for them afterwards. And I gotta say, I go to that luncheon every single year, and what a rewarding event it is. It's always incredible to hear the incredible work that is done to get those people back together. And I know many of you live that life every day, and it makes me proud to just be in the room with all of you because of what you do for humanity. So, you know, on behalf of all of us here at Caesar's Palace, I want to thank you for what you do every day and for taking a little bit of your very important time to be here with us in Las Vegas. So I can't think of a more important conference that we have here at Caesar's Palace based on the subject matter that you're here to study. So I want to thank you, Dr. Maddox. I want to thank Mary Ellen, the faculty, and everyone here on my team, from Stacy, who's been handling the conference for 28 years now, and for all the people in banquets and conventions that are really, really working very hard to make sure this week is as smooth and productive for you as absolutely possible. So thank you all for being here. Please enjoy yourselves while in our care and have a great day. Take care.
It is my opportunity now to set the stage and to cover a few ground rules. I've already declared that this meeting is open and beginning. I will try to cover most of the things that are on this graphic, and we already have over 1,300 attendees from 49 states and the District of Columbia. Rhode Island is not represented. There are 28 foreign countries. You're not to smoke in the convention area. Use your smart devices. Don't put them away, and I'll indicate to you where you should use them during the meeting. Do visit the exhibit hall. You have badges with a number, more on that in a few moments. And there is a learner session this afternoon at the end of the day. We encourage all of the residents, fellows, and other learners to be at that session. The evaluation forms, your CME activities, the MOC activities, as well as questions to the panels will be through the navigator on your communication devices. The conflicts of interest have been addressed by each of the speakers. If you determine that you feel there is any conflict of interest, please report them to the front desk. There's a Tuesday night reception, more on that later, and Tuesday lunchtime is open, and there are some options for you that will be attained through booths in the halls. The syllabus material is included on a thumb drive in your conference tote bag. We announced in the meeting announcement that this is the last year that we were going to make a syllabus, but the syllabus was going to be on the thumb drive, and that we would, if you pre-ordered a syllabus, you could pick that syllabus up, and we brought limited extra copies for purchase. This is in keeping with a number of other national organizations to go green, to save on cost, and we have had some kickback. If you are of the opinion that this is a good decision, tell us, and we will continue to deliver the syllabus in the same way as we delivered it this year on the thumb drive. You also can download the syllabus onto your computer, laptop, whatever, or you can purchase a copy this year as long as copies exist. If you're of the opinion that you like the paper, you'd like to take notes on it, it will be an extra cost for that syllabus and on the registration. Do let us know which direction you wish us to go in the future. The course network is listed here. The password is case sensitive, and that network is available to you. I want everyone's attention. Take off your name tag, or at least look at your name tag. That name tag has, in the lower left-hand corner, a number. Right now, write that number down somewhere. Done. Now, write it down someplace else, because half of you will lose that. Put it on your notes and your on your phone. Put it somewhere, so that you will use this number to get your MOC credits, your continuing education credits, and you'll use that to get into the navigator. I would recommend that you do not discard your name badge until you have downloaded the certificate of attendance and your certificate of credits so that you can give that to whatever regulatory agency is reviewing your program. And that way, if you want to get back into downloading a second time your certificate, you can do so. If you brought your own router, portable router, you can use that. Or you can use the Wi-Fi from Caesar's Palace on the site that I have given you. You can use the QR scanner to get you into that same site and lead you into the Wi-Fi location. This system allows you to verify attendance, course evaluation. The MOC questions are there. You can take those MOC questions as soon as a given section is completed, that will be activated. For many who attended the disaster course yesterday, they have already completed all of their MOC questions, and some have already downloaded their certificate. Download that certificate, and you also have a navigator that leads you to ask questions of the moderator. You select the section where the lectures are being given, then you ask the question that goes straight to the moderator. Kenji, stand up. Hold up the device. Your questions go directly into this device. He then can collate them and use them on the podium, and there's none of this exchange of paper and walking up and down the aisles and the like. So there are five functions of the navigator, and I've cited them to you. This is how the navigator looks. You also can use the little symbols and get into Facebook and get into Twitter. If you get into Twitter and you use a couple of the sites, you will automatically, with the replicating and the retwittering, go to 50,000 people. And that then will be a multiplier. So if you wish to communicate with folks, that's a way to do it. The deadline for completing your MOC questions for this course is Wednesday, April 27th this year. As part of the joy of learning, these questions have been submitted, and we will then submit the answers to the website May 1st, and you can download those if you wish. The describe in detail, I don't need to go over that again. You're able to divide your credits depending upon what you need the most, like pediatric trauma, critical care, and that selection will be given to you. But you can only select one of those trauma, PD, ethics per talk. If you take, I've already given you the deadline, no exceptions. Well, nope. No exceptions. And then you'll download a certificate that looks something like that. If the name that you logged into is on your name tag, if it's hyphenated or whatever, use that hyphen. But you do not need to use titles. The site at KMatics1 is the one which will contact the most people, but you can use any of those Facebook or Twitter sites if you wish to communicate back home to friends around the world or have them communicate to you. Budget the bandwidth that is here. It is the more bandwidth that we use simultaneously, slower the system will be. We're assured it is sufficient. All right, so you enter the dashboard, you go to the trauma session, you choose the session by number, you type in your question, you submit, it goes immediately straight forward. Unless you complete the verification of attendance, The computer will not generate your certificate. A few other announcements. We've posted on a rolling screen a number of things in the foyer. There are some employment opportunities that may appear there, as well as the attendees at the conference. Wear your badge. It's required at the general sessions, the luncheon, and the Tuesday reception. And the barcode expedites your exchange of information. The exhibitors have purchased the space. They help keep the cost of the course down. Do communicate with them. There are the lunch today is in the Augustus Ballroom down the hall. On Tuesday, there are independent satellite luncheons, and it's a free time. Monday evening, it's Meet the Masters. I have announced that earlier. And all residents, fellows, and students, we really urge you to come, and other people who wish to be learners as well are welcome. It's mainly aimed at those in training. This year, we presented a scholarship to the runners-up in the final contest and offered scholarships, and those who accepted the scholarships and are attending at this conference are listed on this slide. Dr. Cow, Dr. Lassie, Dr. Lupins, Dr. Smith. Tuesday night reception, you get to meet the faculty. There's music, there's dancing, and your badge admits two people. Minors are not allowed in that alcohol is served. Before I talked about the forms for conflict of interest. Our first session is hot button issues. Our moderator is Kenji Inaba. Please help me to welcome Kenji Inaba to the podium.
All right, thanks, Dr. Maddox. It is truly an honor to be here moderating the first session. There are seven fantastic talks. Now, some of the speakers have been coming here for a very long time. Others are new, but they're all very experienced speakers and surgeons, and I think you guys are really going to enjoy this. So we're going to start things off with Ali Salim, one of my closest friends, as you know. He's a professor of surgery at Harvard Medical School, a division chief at the Brigham and Women's Hospital for Trauma, Critical Care, and Burns. And he's going to be talking to us about unstable patients in the ER. Should they be going to imaging or to the operating room? Ali?
Well, good morning. It's a pleasure for me to be here. It's always sort of a highlight of the year for me to be here and spend time at this fantastic meeting. So I have nothing to disclose. So really, my talk is about having an unstable patient. You really have two choices. Should they go to radiology, get some imaging, or do they need to go to the operating room? I think the choice is pretty clear. Unstable patients need to go to the operating room. Why? Because the majority of cases, the majority of reasons that patients are unstable is because of bleeding. And how do we know that? If we look at the mortality for our trauma patients, a significant majority of our patients are dying from some sort of bleeding. So if you have an unstable patient here with pressure below 90, these patients are bleeding until proven otherwise. And if they're bleeding, they need to go to the operating room and stop the bleeding. Now, there are sort of nuances to this. There are caveats to this, you know. So we know in the emergency room we're actually resuscitating our patients. And then the response to resuscitation also should dictate where our patients go. And we'll actually talk about that in a little while. But for those patients who don't respond to the resuscitation, those patients are bleeding, they need to have some sort of surgical control. But the challenge for us is to try to identify where these patients are bleeding from. And luckily, there's really only a certain number of places patients will be bleeding from. And I think we all sort of know, you know, sort of the favorite medical school student resident question, like, how do you quickly identify where patients are bleeding from? Really within 5 minutes, right? So we know patients could be bleeding from these areas. Standard, the scalp, the chest, the abdomen, the pelvis or retroperitoneum, the extremity, and we also like to say the floor or the street, they bled at the scene. So our job is to quickly identify where they're bleeding and then to fix the problem at that time. So if it's scalp, you know, our patients are bleeding, you can pretty much handle this in the emergency room. Rarely these patients need to go to the operating room, but occasionally they will have to. What about chest? You know, it's either a chest x-ray will tell us what we need to know, or if not the chest x-ray, The FAST exam will tell us what we need to do. And usually that patient also needs to go to the operating room. They're unstable and blood in the chest or blood around the pericardium, those patients need to go to the operating room. Abdomen, same thing. FAST is gonna tell us what we need to know. And on the rare occasion where the FAST isn't as helpful, I think there still could be a role for doing your DPL, or really the diagnostic peritoneal aspirate part, not the lavage part, but the aspirate, if you're not confident with what your FAST is saying. Then the pelvis, very simple. You do a pelvis x-ray, and the first thing you can do is temporize by putting a binder, and then you can, depending on what your institution's algorithm is, you either go to angio for IR, and if angio is not available, maybe you need to go to the operating room and you can do your pelvic packing. I think we'll be talking about that today. And even now, more and more, we're really starting to see maybe Reboa may have a use in these patients. I know Dr. DuBose is gonna talk about that today, and Dr. Schreiber is actually gonna talk about using Reboa in pelvic fractures tomorrow, so we'll see. And then extremity, and this is very straightforward. You're bleeding from the extremity, what are you gonna do? You're gonna put pressure on it, right? If that's not gonna help, you're gonna put tourniquets on it. But those patients need to go to the operating room. Finally, the whole concept of the floor or the street, and that's really just patients who are bleeding out from some sort of injury that you've identified from the sort of choices that we went through. Those sort of the patients bleeding at the street. But that's when it's simple. But there's still an occasional group of patients that we just don't know. These are unstable patients. And what if you can't identify where they're bleeding from? Is there a role for imaging in this group of patients? And the people who sort of advocate for doing imaging, really for several reasons, right? These newer CAT scans are just much quicker. You can actually get patients to CAT scan, get the diagnosis within minutes. At least that's what they say. And what about like the newer trauma centers? The proximity to the CAT scanner is very close. And in fact, as we sort of review trauma centers, one of the questions that we ask is, what is the distance between radiology and your trauma bay? Because it's actually very important. And the newer trauma centers are now being built with radiology adjacent to your trauma bay. So you have the combination of these adjacent radiology suites plus really fast CAT scans. So maybe in those patients who are unstable, is there a role for doing that? Interestingly, there's been a number of studies that have come out that's actually looking at this very thing, sort of the role of CAT scan in patients who are hemodynamically or unstable. Probably the first study to look at this came out of Europe several years ago. What's interesting is what they did is they sort of compared patients who had whole body CAT scanning versus patients who didn't. And they categorized them into three groups. They looked at all patients. They looked at patients who were mildly unstable, sort of the moderate shock, 90 to 100. And then they looked at severe shock, which they defined as less than 90. I mean, we can quibble with that definition of really what severe shock is. But interestingly, what they found is that overall, those patients who had whole body scanning, it actually improved mortality. It really can't account for why there's a mortality benefit. But those patients who got whole body scanning actually did better. And then when they looked at the subgroups of shock, those patients, whether it was moderate shock or severe shock, those patients actually did better. So what they concluded was that doing a whole body scan, even in patients who are in shock, can be safe. And if anything, it may actually confer some mortality benefit. Now, following that, there's another study that sort of looked at patients that needed hemorrhage control. And they basically took a group of patients that actually had a CAT scan first before they had hemorrhage control. Then they compared those to the patients who had hemorrhage control without a CAT scan. And what they found is that those patients who had the CAT scan first, because the CAT scan was sort of able to determine or direct where they went to the OR in terms of hemorrhage control, those patients actually did better. And clearly, these are all retrospective. We can sort of argue about, like, you know, sort of the methodology of these papers. But still, the common theme is that these patients, if they get scanned, regardless if they're unstable, maybe they are doing better. Now, out of Japan, a very interesting study. Basically, it's a retrospective study looking at their trauma data bank. And what they did is they looked at all blunt trauma patients who are unstable. And their definition of unstable was a systolic of less than 90. Again, this is just that one isolated blood pressure in the ED, less than 90. And then they compared patients who got CAT scan versus those patients who didn't. Interestingly, the majority of patients got CAT scan. So I think if you really look at this critically, it probably wasn't that sick of a cohort. Nevertheless, the patients who got CAT scan who were unstable actually did better. Their 24-hour mortality was better, and their in-hospital mortality was better compared to those patients who didn't. So again, the conclusion that they're saying is that, you know what, maybe we can consider doing a CAT scan in these patients that are unstable. Maybe it actually improves survival, but at the minimum, nobody did badly because of getting the CAT scan. Now, they follow that up with another study looking at sort of another group of patients. Again, they in unstable patients, but also patients with unusual or abnormal vital signs, whether they had hypotension, systolic less than 100, whether they were tachycardic, heart rate of greater than 120, and whether they had some tachypnea or whether they had an altered level of consciousness. Again, comparing patients who had whole body scanning versus those who didn't. And in this group, it was about half of the patients actually got CAT scan. And again, they found that for some reason, those patients who had abnormal vitals, they got CAT scans. Something about that workup sort of conferred a survival advantage. Now, again, they can't say, you know, these are retrospective. So at minimum, what they can say is maybe consider doing a CAT scan in this group of patients. At minimum, it's not detrimental. Again, retrospective studies. Probably the most discussed paper is this one that was presented at AAST, is from Columbia. And what it was sort of a prospective sort of collection of patients with a retrospective review of the data. It was over a 1 year period. They took severely injured patients. This was both blunt and penetrating. And they actually had criteria for how they defined instability. Hypotension, basically any blood pressure less than 100. Tachycardia, any heart rate less greater than 100. Again, we can argue whether this is really a sick group of patients. But the interesting group is they also included patients who needed greater than 4 units of Paxil. So that's probably the sicker group of patients. And what they found was that half of patients, there was 170 patients, half of them actually got a CAT scan. And in that group that got a CAT scan, they were able to avoid operating in nearly half of them. And also, like, the CAT scan also helped direct what type of procedure they did. So it didn't find a mortality benefit like some of the other retrospective, but what it did conclude is that maybe we can consider doing CAT scan in this group of patients because at minimum, patients did not do worse. And it actually improved sort of the process in terms of taking care of them. A group of patients did not need to go to the operating room. So maybe it was helpful in deciding surgical management. But if you really look critically at all of these studies, and it's interesting, they're starting to come up because people are starting to look at this. Really, the definition of hypotension, maybe that's just one blood pressure measurement, whether it was 90, whether it was 100, you can argue whether that's really a hemodynamically unstable group of patients. Also, tachycardia, does that really qualify for someone who's unstable? And none of these studies really talked about what the response to resuscitation was, right? So what if they came in if their blood pressure was 80? But what happens if they got a liter of crystalloid or a unit of blood? Maybe by the time they were resuscitated, their pressure was 120, and then they went to CAT scan. So of course, that group of patients is gonna do better. So the data doesn't really show that. And then it doesn't take into account judgment. We're always at the bedside. We know you can tell a patient who may have a systolic 85, you're right there at the bedside, and you say, you know what? I still need to get a CAT scan, but I'm gonna be with this patient, right? These studies don't take into account that judgment of us at the bedside. So I think it is something to think about, something to sort of read, and I urge you to look at these studies critically. But I think in summary though, like whether you take a patient to imaging or the OR who's unstable, I think you know you have to assume it's bleeding. Bleeding patients need to go to the operating room, right? Unstable patient is bleeding until proven otherwise. You need to have a systematic approach to identifying where they're bleeding and then manage it accordingly. Interestingly, there are studies now, several of them, may not be of high quality, but there are studies that are suggesting that unstable patients may actually benefit, or at least at a minimum, it's not unsafe to take this group of patients to the operating room. But I would admit that there has to be some nuance in this group of patients. I think we all, as physicians at the bedside, could recognize and use our judgment in terms of which patients could actually benefit that are unstable to go to the CAT scan. Because I think the message that we don't want to send is that unstable patients are safe to go to CAT scan. I think we can be judicious, we could be careful, and we can use our judgment and identify what group of patients that is that would actually benefit. Thank you.
Thanks, Ali. And now we're going to have Joe DeBose up. Joe is a professor of surgery at the Uniformed Services University of Health Sciences, and he is the director of the Baltimore Center for the Sustainment of Trauma and Readiness Skills. Joe is going to be talking to us about REBOA and what we should be doing now in 2019. Joe.
Thanks, Gingy. So I don't have any disclosures related to this hot button topic, but I will disclose to all of you that non-compressible torsional hemorrhage keeps me up at night, both literally and figuratively. All these patients need to be in the operating room, as Dr. Saleem very nicely outlined, but I'm just trying to get them there and get them there in a reasonable shape so that they have an optimal chance for survival. In the combat environment, 62% of all early combat deaths are due to non-compressible torso hemorrhage. That worries me when I have my military uniform on. And also in the civilian realm. If you look at, this is a very nice study that also illustrates that mortality from hemorrhage at non-compressible sites in the civilian realm using NTDB data is approximately 45%. Here's our answer for generations, right? Patients decompensating, not responding to our attempts at resuscitation. This is how we get them to survival to the operative theater, resuscitative thoracotomy in the emergency department. Now, if you want to see how we've been doing over the last couple of years, I refer you to a couple of resources. The EAST reference in 2013 is fantastic. It reviewed 40 years of previous experience. And then if you want to look at a more contemporary experience, our own AAST aorta registry, which captures aortic occlusion no matter whether it's by clamp or balloon in the setting of trauma and acute care surgery, which now has about 588 REBOA patients. So when you juxtapose looking at ED thoracotomy, the aorta data, and the pool data from the EAST study, which is 2013 or 40 years prior, the punchline here is that resuscitative thoracotomy is being utilized in the same way with the same results for over 40 years. There's been no new innovations. Can we do better? Can we improve our opportunity to get these patients to the operating room? Dr. Maddox was a leader in 1979, just like he is today, and tried to help us find a way to intercept that patient sooner in the course of their decompensation to get them to definitive surgery in the operating room. They experimented with truncal hemorrhage with open exploratory laparotomies in the emergency department. That did not pan out at that point in time, but in his discussion, he did call for the exploration of intra-aortic tamponading balloons. And out of that, that continued evolution from Dr. Maddox's advice has been developed the resuscitative endovascular balloon occlusion of the aorta, or REBOA. And this has been used in some of the other surgical ultimate models of non-compressible hemorrhage. I can't think of a better example than the ruptured AAA. If you presented with hypotension and a ruptured abdominal aneurysm, your mortality was greater than 50% prior to the advent and more aggressive utilization of balloon occlusion proximally so those patients could get to the operative theater. Frank Veith and others showed us some of that data and convinced a lot of the military vascular surgeons who then went on to start some of these examinations. Now, if you're gonna look at REBOA in the context of trauma, you have to divide it in a couple of areas. So let's talk about the pre-endovascular era. We're talking about the 1980s here. Balloons were not at their maturation. Technologies were not quite there. People had limited experience. There's some small studies with really poor results. We had training limitations and significant device limitations. But in that span of time, as war in Afghanistan and Iraq start to build up and you had military vascular surgeons who wanted to explore the utilization of this technology, they built translational labs and got some DoD funding and explored the use of REBOA for trauma indications. And out of that came some true algorithms for potential clinical use, some vernacular that we could use as a common language, and a pathway for potential success. Out of that also came some trauma-specific devices. Gone are the long days of the 8-foot wire hanging off the end of the bed and the Coda balloon, which is really not designed for what the applications that we want to use it for. And in through the door came some more trauma-specific devices that really had their roots in some of those military labs in San Antonio. Also with that came training. The basic endovascular skills for trauma course developed by the American College of Surgeons now 4 years ago, we recognized if we're going to use this technology, you have to train in it. You don't throw it in your backpack and see a PowerPoint slide and expect to be able to do this well. This course teaches the indications, the important elements of common femoral artery access, which truly is the rate limiting step in the gateway to the utilizations technology. It talks about the tools and it talks about the techniques. In the context of that, we do emphasize common femoral arterial access. You cannot do REBOA without it. As a side product, early common femoral artery access in many of these patients who are hemodynamically unstable provides a second-to-second measurement as opposed to waiting for the blood pressure cuff to cycle every 3 minutes. So we capture those dynamic changes in decompensation earlier and are able to respond. The use of ultrasound is paramount to success, in my personal opinion here, and this is what we teach in the BEST course. For some reason, in the emergency department, ultrasound is used sparingly, about 20%, according to most recent figures from the order registry. We can and need to do better because it does make us better at getting early and effective access. But the emphasis of the course and the training is that these patients, VRBOA is not an end-all be-all. It is simply to salvage those patients who would otherwise die in the emergency department and get them to the operating room for an opportunity for definitive intervention and improved survival. We also have learned over the past 5 or 6 years that complications related to VRBOA, they're predictable and avoidable. This is a very nice paper that we put together outlining essentially at every step what can go wrong and what you can do to avoid it. Anyone who's gonna entertain you employing VRBOA at their institution, I think, should read it. I don't have time to go through all the potential complications, but I will talk about two of the main catch points here, occlusion time and then sheath mismanagement and complications. How long can this balloon be up? I have a patient who's not responded to resuscitation in the emergency department, and I'm gonna put that balloon in the zone one of the aorta. We know and have extrapolated from abdominal aortic surgery that about 30 minutes of total occlusion time reaches the realm of lunacy in most of these patients. And that's confounded by the fact that these patients often come in with some physiologic burden before we even put the balloon up. And that's variable, and this remains, for that reason, a very active area of study as we try to push forward with that. In my own practice, I think that modifications of the traditional just put the balloon up and run to the OR technique are going to be useful. I utilize early partial VRBOA, and this slide very nicely outlines the rationale, but I'll really dummy it down for you because this is how I have to think about it. What I'm employing are the lessons Dr. Maddox taught me 20 years ago in Houston talking about hypotensive resuscitation. With a partial occlusion of the balloon, I can titrate now this aortic control to afford normal tension for the heart and brain and employ that hypotensive principle below the balloon so that I don't disrupt the clot, but the tissues are not frankly ischemic below the balloon. And Matt Martin and others who have investigated this stuff have clearly shown that in animal hemorrhagic models, this is gonna be beneficial. You can see there in the gray, the patients who've had who had total occlusion simply do worse in terms of the lactate buildup and the reperfusion indicators relative to partial control. And we also know there's probably a sweet spot. If you read that Maddox paper, it talks very much about having enough pressure to perfuse the organs, but not so much to disrupt the clot. And we're learning that, Matt Martin and others are teaching us that there is a sweet spot to the flow rates that you need to achieve with that balloon in order to achieve just that zone of optimal utilization. The other issue now that I'll touch on briefly is what about the sheath? These sheaths that we have to utilize are getting smaller in size. I think that is one of the major benefits to the novel devices. But late limb complications are the most common etiology. This is pure and simple, has less to do with the balloon going up and down than it does with sheath mismanagement postoperatively. I emphasize removing the sheath prior to leaving the operating room whenever possible. If you need arterial monitoring access, get it somewhere else where it's gonna be less problematic in the intensive care unit setting in a patient that I'm giving TXA, FFP, and creating a thrombogenic state. But that is emphasized heavily in our course. I know I need to get to the punchline. Dr. Maddox tells me success is better than what we did in the 1980s, and I need to get to that. So I'm gonna move quickly to what our actual data is here. I'm gonna talk over four sources. All the sources for data on this topic are inherently flawed, and we'll talk a little bit about that. But one of our first sources was the Japanese experience. They had approximately 20 years prior to the utilization in North America of VRBOA for trauma indications, and they had some warning signs here. They had papers where limbs were lost. They had papers where that were suggestive that VRBOA may not be actually helpful at all in these patients. It may even be dangerous. But there are differences in the Japanese system that we can't extrapolate to the North American system. They don't have trauma surgeons in-house. Most of these balloons are placed by a third-year ER resident or interventional radiology resident in an attempt to help the trauma surgeon get through Tokyo traffic to the patient. And they're placed zone one regardless of pattern of injury, and they had prolonged sheath times in all those studies. So it's a little different than what we employ in America. This is an exceptionally important paper. It's controversial. It's some outstanding work. Dr. Bilal Joseph and his group looked at the TQIP data, so utilized one of our premier trauma registries and matched the 140 patients from a time window of VRBOA utilization to patients who did not receive VRBOA. And they found higher limb amputation rates, higher acute kidney injury, and higher mortality. All these have, the fault is not with the investigators here, it's with the data that they potentially had in terms of their limitations. The fault is in their stars, and that's the data. Some of the issues with this one that I have personally, we've talked to Bilal Joseph, who's a good friend of mine, we debate this constantly at the bar, is that the seven French sheaths just came online at the end of 2016. I know in cross-reference to the aorta registry, there were really only two institutions that were using the seven French. It came into greater force the following year. We don't know, and this is an inherent limitation in any trauma registry. I don't know what the inclusion times are. We can't settle that debate because the registry simply doesn't tell us. We don't know how to separate to some degree, particularly with limb complications, whether this was a REBOA or a sheath complication. And most importantly, you can match for the injury patterns, you can match for age, hypotension on presentation, but what no registry or data presently available captures is how that patient responds to resuscitation. So the patients that have the same injuries, but one response to 250 cc's of fluid now is no longer hypotensive, ends up compared to the patient who continues to decompensate and gets a REBOA. Not probably a fair comparison, in my opinion, but it's exceedingly challenging to capture in this particular registries. We do have some additional registries that are online, the aorta registry, but again, there's no comparison group to the patients who respond to resuscitation here. This is only aortic occlusion. It's been accruing since November 2013 in nearly 600 trauma patients. And I would say from that study, it has provided us a lot of foundational data. We know that from this registry that REBOA can be safely performed by trained, and I emphasize that word, trauma and acute care surgeons. The newer devices appear to have lower complications relative to the older 12 French devices. Complication types are pretty consistent, pretty predictable, and in my opinion, avoidable with appropriate training. And at least it's at least as equivalent as resuscitative thoracotomy across the board, maybe superior in specific subsets. One of those subsets is those patients who have not yet required CPR. This is kind of some slides from the NICE investigation that we did looking at overall outcomes following a REBOA and resuscitative thoracotomy. Both of these slides above and below, those are patients who required either pre-hospital CPR or CPR after arrival, but prior to aortic occlusion. You can see the outcomes are no different. But in those patients who did not yet require CPR, REBOA conferred a survival advantage. Now, part of that makes sense, right? No one's, patients who doesn't have has not yet required CPR, putting a scalpel to their chest is likely to result to a swift kick in the face. But you can get femoral access and put a REBOA in their aorta and potentially titrate the aortic control in those patients who are not responding. The summary of this is that among partial non-responders who have not yet required CPR, REBOA appears superior in survival to resuscitative thoracotomy. After CPR started, you can do ED thoracotomy, REBOA, stand on one leg, and the outcomes are likely to be the same. But in clinical utilization, and this is important here, REBOA and resuscitative thoracotomy populations are different. REBOA is primarily a tool for blunt mechanisms, or has been historically, and it's more likely to have those patients undergoing REBOA have some measurable blood pressure at the time of REBOA. So what I've come to in my evolution of utilizing this tool on a daily basis as both a vascular and trauma surgeon is that you cannot compare apples to oranges to bananas. Resuscitation works in the majority of patients, and that should not be compared to REBOA, should not be compared to resuscitative thoracotomy. This, to me, represents a diagram of how these things all fit into the practice of the acutely decompensating patient that I'm just trying to get to the operating room to give them a chance. Resuscitation is going to, most patients will respond. Probably you could say the resuscitative arm could be larger there. A number of those patients early in the phase before CPR may benefit from REBOA, and aortic occlusion, regardless of how you get it, is a tool thereafter. We have a lot of areas under investigation with the REBOA, and rightfully so, ranging from optimal balloon utilization, techniques, adjunctive resuscitation, REBOA in different areas. If you think about a global health burden perspective, it's obstetrical hemorrhage is more important than perhaps than trauma. But if I had to summarize where we are in 2019 in two slides, these are the notes. REBOA is a tool that can be used for aortic occlusion in partial or non-responders to resuscitation, not in patients who respond to resuscitation. And for the majority of patients in whom it may be utilized, REBOA outcomes appear to be equivalent to resuscitative thoracotomy, just as good. Complications are predictable and likely to be avoided with proper training. We do recommend appropriate training for everyone. It's a tool that requires collaborative approach. You need a team, you need a construct at your institution to utilize it, and we have a lot of work to do in terms of additional research. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Joe. All right, now we're going to have Rick Sidwell comes up. I think everybody knows Rick. He's a professor of surgery at the University of Iowa, long-standing speaker here. He is absolutely fantastic, and he's going to be telling us today about how we should manage trauma patients without the use of narcotics, a very timely topic. Rick.
Okay. Well, good morning, folks. All of us will give thanks to Dr. Maddox and to Mary and to the program committee because it is truly, truly an honor to be here. Now, it's a terrifying honor, but it's an honor. Before I get started, you guys have to humor me for just a second, and anyone out here who has a mother will understand this. My mom knows what I do. I mean, I've explained to her, okay, I'm a surgeon, and she understands that, and she understands I take care of injured people. She gets that part of it. What she doesn't really get is when I try to explain to her that, oh, no, I get to teach, too, and get to talk to people. And so, but she doesn't really get that. And so here's what I need to do. This is for my mom. I'm not joking here. I need, because I'm going to send a picture of all y'all to my mom. And so I need this side of the room. Y'all, hang on. I need y'all over here. Well, we'll just do it this way, quick. I need this side of the room. Just wave your hand, say hi, mom. Ready? One, two, three. That's good. Now this side of the room, real quick. Wave your hand. One, two, three. Okay, that's terrific. Thank you. I'm going to send that to my mom, and really, probably by the panel session, she'll be saying hi to all of you as well. I don't have any disclosures, other than I will say that I am going to be talking about some medications, and I'm going to be talking about a particular device. I think that I'm talking about on-label use, but I don't really know. I just use the medication. So. We have an opioid problem. That's not new news. Injured patients need pain control. That's not new news. Without good pain control, the injured patients have, they develop chronic pain, they have longer lengths of stay, they develop post-traumatic stress. So we have to have a way of managing the pain. The graph here shows what we all know, and that is that over time now, opioid use is increasing. Well, and there's lots of reasons for that. We have to accept that us as doctors, that we are part of the problem. Now, a well-intentioned part of the problem, but we are part of the problem. And this is me completely. I bought into all of this, and pain is the fifth vital sign. I'm giving plenty of pain medication and try to avoid the phone calls coming back to the office and blah, blah, blah. This was me. Well, then there are some things that come up that will make us reconsider. And for me, that was 2017. And two things happened in that year. First, this is my mom. This is the one I'm going to send a picture to. Okay, and in summer of 2017, my mother had a lung cancer, and she needed a thoracotomy and lobectomy to take care of that. Well, she had an epidural while she was in the hospital, and after that was removed, she took a single dose of hydrocodone, and she didn't like the way that it made her feel. And so then when she left the hospital on post-op day number 6, she left without taking a single narcotic medication at all. She was taking Tylenol. That was it. And that got me thinking. Okay, this kind of frailish older lady who had some broken ribs during her thoracotomy, and she went home without taking a single narcotic. What's up with all my trauma patients who are whiny and need their refill after refill after refill? So that was playing on my mind in summer and fall of 2017. And then this happened. This is Dr. Andrew Bernard, and Dr. Bernard's sitting right over here in the corner. He's on our panel here this morning. And Dr. Bernard came to Kansas City, and he presented at our Advances in Trauma meeting in December. And he was presenting about opioid use, and it was a great, great presentation, blah, blah, blah. But he showed this slide. Now, there's a lot of stuff on here, and there's a lot of references at the bottom. But here's what I took away, and this was the most important thing that I took away from what he was presenting, is when you start up at the top, that is 100 opiate-naive patients. Okay, we're not talking about the chronic opiate users, blah, blah, blah. This is 100 opiate-naive patients who were just trying to do our best job taking care of them and managing their pain. What happens to those 100 people? Well, down in the lower left corner, there's 30 of them that end up having medication that is just laying around that can be diverted or misused. There are 10 that become either dependent or chronically misused. There's one that becomes a heroin addict, and then there's another one that dies. Now, this made a big impact on me. So I'd already been thinking about my mother, and now Dr. Bernard tells me that for every 100 people that I try to treat their pain, I'm creating 10 addicts and maybe killing one person. That's crazy. So, if you're going to read one paper related to this topic, I recommend Dr. Bernard's paper. I've included it. It's the top reference in your syllabus. So here's what I want to do. I want to briefly describe some non-opioid pharmacologic options. I'm going to present to you how we use that at our institution. This is a nuts and bolts presentation. And then I'm going to spend the last part showing you how to do a specific regional technique to manage pain with rib fractures. So let's get going. Non-pharmacologic options. Acetaminophen, widely available, safe. It works through inhibition of prostaglandin synthesis and then some biochemistry stuff after that. You can use up to 4 grams a day. And yeah, it has some toxicities. It's liver toxicity, so you need to be careful with the cirrhotics and the people who are at risk. This IV formulation thing, it works. It does give a more rapid onset of action, but after that, everything is the same. The peak action, the duration of action is the same, and it's expensive. And you know what? At our place, because we couldn't really follow the rules all that well, at our place, it's banned, other than use in pediatrics. Non-steroidals. So non-steroidals are also, in general, safe. They do have an additional side effect profile that includes renal toxicity and GI bleeding and some platelet dysfunction. But then the thing that's probably most relevant to the trauma patient is the whole question about how do non-steroidals affect fracture healing. And so the non-steroidals also have an effect on prostaglandin synthesis. And the prostaglandins have a somewhat complex role in regulation of fracture healing. In vitro studies and animal studies is where most of the information comes from. Actual human trials aren't all that common. My interpretation is that the retrospective studies looking at fracture healing in humans, the retrospective studies actually show that non-steroidals make fracture healing worse. Now, the flip side of that is that the prospective studies, it doesn't make a difference. And so the way that I rationalize all this in my mind is that, yeah, I'm going to use the non-steroidals, and we just treat them as any other risk factor for fracture healing. So, yeah, I'm going to use them. I'm going to use them in caution with the people who have their systemic risk factors, be it their renal disease or GI bleeding or whatever. I'm going to use it in caution in the patients who have the complex high-risk injuries, multiple fractures, open fractures, spine injuries, especially the ones that need an operation. In fairness, I do run this by the orthopedist or the neurosurgeon. But yeah, we can use non-steroidals safely in the injured person. Gabapentin. Gabapentin works through modulating axonal transmission. It involves things like glutamate and norepinephrine and substance P. I don't really know how gabapentin works, but it does have a role in chronic neuropathic pain. Its role in acute pain is much less clear. I use it. It has this emerging concern about potential recreational abuse because of GABA mimetic effect. So stay tuned on that. And then finally are the muscle relaxants. These work by relaxing smooth muscle. These are things that are best really for low back injuries. So in the muscle, the pain that's associated with spasm in the low back. So put all of this together, and I'm going to run through this quickly. This part is in your syllabus. This is how we use it. Now, this is our routine trauma admission. This is not people going to the ICU. This is just our routine run-of-the-mill trauma admission. We do not have a pain service. when there are multiple services, so trauma and orthopedics and neurosurgery, when all those services are involved, it's the trauma surgeons who manage the pain, just to avoid, you know, multiple doctors. First thing we do, everybody gets Tylenol. Everybody gets gabapentin. I don't really know if the gabapentin works. If nothing else, it gives us something we can adjust up and down a little bit to make people think that we're trying to help. Yikes, did that come out? Selective use of non-steroidal, selective use of muscle relaxants. For the patients who can't take oral, now we let people take oral with sips of medications even if they are having an operation. But for whatever reason, if they cannot take oral medication, we do use the ketorolac. Unfortunately, the acetaminophen is limited to children at our place. It's only when we get into step three that we start to use some narcotic stuff. And this is what I think is really important, and this is a change in my thinking over the last 18 months. Those combination medications, Norco, Vicodin, Percocet, we don't use those. And we do that specifically because we want to maximize the acetaminophen component and then minimize the narcotic component. So then we add in, you know, some oxycodone there if we need to. Only as necessary, we don't schedule it. And then it's only when we get down to step four that we will selectively use some narcotic, Dilaudid, fentanyl, et cetera. So that's how we do it. And I've got that all written out in the syllabus. What I want to show in my remaining couple of minutes here is a specific technique for management of rib fracture pain. And I don't know about y'all, but rib fractures are the bane of our trauma service. Everybody hurts with them. And there's nothing wrong, for example, with epidural management. At our place, it's something that we don't use a lot of for a variety of reasons. And so this is the technique where you can do a regional block, something that all of us can do locally at the bedside. Again, I don't have any disclosures. This is an on-cue system that we use. So it's an elastomeric pump that's loaded with local anesthetic. And then that is constantly infused through this catheter that has a soaker component. We use it for patients who have three or more rib fractures or patients who were having a hard time controlling their pain. So here's the case. It's an elderly person who's got some rib fractures with the flail segment. He's having some trouble breathing. This is in the emergency room. And I'm going to show you how we put that in. First, you lay him on their side. And I've got the landmarks marked out. So these are the vertebral bodies marked out. And this catheter goes in a paravertebral position, so just outside the thoracic cavity, just outside on the surface of the ribs. It's done with full barrier precautions. We've had one wound infection with this, and it was at a time when we didn't use the full barrier precautions, so use full barrier precautions. The catheter, this is the catheter, and it has this soaker portion that will constantly infuse a low drip rate of local anesthetic. Infiltrate the site, and then you're going to make a skin incision. So now this skin incision is made below the most inferior rib fracture. So typically you're down along the 12th rib, something like that. What's important here is what you're about just to see, is that this dissection needs to get all the way down to the chest wall, because you want to get right on top of the thoracic cage, so that then eventually this catheter will slide nice and easily up. So you make your dissection. Then this catheter, I'm going backwards, sorry folks, wrong button. Then this catheter gets tunneled. So this is just like tunneling a central line, any tunneled catheter that we all would put in. You tunnel this catheter out to an exit site, and you choose this exit site out laterally simply so that the patient isn't laying on it the whole time that they're laying in bed. Once it's tunneled out there, then the catheter comes through. So the catheter comes through, and then it's a split sheath that pulls away. Here's what then we're going to do next, is we're going to tunnel this into a position, in a paravertebral position along the chest wall, and it looks like this. If you're in the right plane, this tunneler will just slide right along the outside of the ribs. Now, this is being done The person who's doing this is a first-year surgical resident. This is the first time that she's done the procedure. She's being coached by a second-year resident, and she's got me taking the video. So this is a simple procedure that anybody can learn. This is being done in the emergency room with local anesthesia and no sedation. Okay, so then the catheter goes in, you secure it in place, and you hook it up to the pump, and then this thing stays in place for 5 days. Now, I've actually, the whole video is online. I've included this link in your syllabus, so you can watch the whole video, and I have it narrated. Anyway, simple thing. And then he ends up doing well. He has measurable improvements in his respiratory function. So, what do I really want you to take from this? Number one is that we can, with just a little bit of thought and effort, we can minimize our use of opiates in the trauma patient. Second, take away this whole idea of the combination medications. That's a nuts and bolts thing that you can take home and minimize the amount of narcotic that you're using. And then I hope you've learned a little bit of how I show how to do this on Q catheter. Again, thank you all for having us here. Very great.
Thanks so much, Rick. And next, we're going to have Marty Schreiber come up. Marty, everybody already knows, I'm sure, is a professor of surgery and the chief of trauma, surgical critical care, and burns at OHSU. And he's going to be telling us about whole blood. Marty.
Thanks, Kenji. Good morning, everyone. It's great to be back here in Las Vegas at this wonderful conference. I'm going to tell you the story of whole blood this morning, all the way from the beginning to the end of exactly where we are right now. If you're interested in what I'm telling you, you can read a book. It's called Blood, and it will tell you this whole story in 1,000 pages instead of 15 minutes, like I'm going to tell you right now. So first of all, we all know hemorrhage is a leading cause of preventable death after trauma. The goal is to stop the bleed. Resuscitation is secondary. Stop the bleed is primary. We are the first responders. When somebody's bleeding, we need to stop the bleeding. In the street or in the hospital, doesn't matter. Whole blood resuscitates the patients and restores hemostasis. What I did with whole blood in theater is not what I do in the civilian world. They are vastly different, and I'm going to talk about that. We all know that trauma and resuscitation causes coagulopathy and all those problems on the bottom. The components of whole blood are the ideal components to reverse all of the problems you see at the bottom of that slide. Whole blood as a resuscitation fluid treats every single thing you see there. Reverses dysfunctional inflammation, stops hyperfibrinolysis, restores fibrinogen function, restores the endothelium, and restores normal platelet function. Fresh whole blood is the ideal solution to do every single one of those things. Now I'm going to tell you the story all the way back to the future. Way back in the 17th century, we were much smarter than we are now. We knew that if somebody's bleeding, we should give them whole blood. And this started with Richard Lower. Richard Lower was an English physician that wore a wig in the 17th century. He studied the heart and the lungs and circulation and realized that blood drove the function of all the organs. He took a dog, exsanguinated it, took another dog, took all of its blood and put it into this exsanguinated dog. The dog receiving the blood transfusion survived. The dog that was exsanguinated died. He got it. If you bleed to death, you die. If you replace the blood, you live. And that was the first successful blood transfusion in the history of man. Philip Seeing Physick is commonly known as the father of American surgery. He practiced in Philadelphia. He learned from John Hunter, who was Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. He did the first successful human transfusion of a large volume. Now, between those two doctors, Lower and Physick, there were many failed attempts from all kinds of different animals to humans and humans to humans. Lots of failed attempts, but these two were successful. Many of you do not know it, but there were two successful large volume blood transfusions of whole blood in the Civil War. And this is the beginning of war medicine that changing reconfiguring civilian medicine. Two successful transfusions, beautiful descriptions of exsanguinating patients with restored pulses. Both of them got amputations, both survived. Alexis Carrel was one of 9 surgeons to receive the Nobel Prize. He got it for inventing the anastomosis. And in World War I, people got transfusions via a vein-to-vein anastomosis. Unfortunately for Alexis Carrel, he was mistaken as a Nazi sympathizer by the French in World War II and died in ignominy. In the 1970s, a disastrous thing happened. We started using large amounts of crystalloid, and we took the whole blood and made it into components and made it much worse. It was disastrous. This is a scene from World War I. A captain in the U.S. Army said, what we need is a fluid that will have the advantages of all salt solutions together with antagonism to the state of acidosis. That was Walter Cannon, a captain in the U.S. Army, World War I, over 100 years ago, and his Canadian colleague, Bruce Robertson, said, well, we have this solution, it's whole blood. And Alexis Carrel and George Crile in World War I were transfusing war fighters with whole blood with great success. George Crile, by the way, founded the Cleveland Clinic. World War II, a funny thing happened. Our military decided all we need is plasma. If you're exsanguinating, all you need is plasma. So they developed lyophilized plasma. It was a multi-donor plasma. It wasn't examined for any pathogen. Lots of people dying from pathogen contaminations from multi-donor lyophilized plasma. Very interesting. Up until 1943, everyone thought, we don't need the red cells, just the plasma. And two-thirds of the blood that was donated in the United States went to making dried plasma. You see there a scene from Salerno with a very young girl looking at that scene. Here's a special forces medic delivering dried plasma to a bleeding soldier, and the young girl's got that funny look on her face. She's saying, but he's bleeding red stuff, and that guy's giving him yellow stuff. I don't understand it. Then this man came along, Edward Churchill. Edward Churchill was a surgeon from Harvard who was commissioned as a colonel in World War II, went downrange, examined what was going on, and said, hey, the British have whole blood. The Russians are taking whole blood out of cadavers and giving it to people. And here we are giving the dried plasma. And the people aren't doing well. Our guys are doing worse than the Russians getting blood from the cadavers. So he went to the Surgeon General and said, we need whole blood. Surgeon General says, can't do it, sorry, not happening. So individual surgeons in the individual units got whole blood from wherever they could. They got it from the soldier and they got it from the local population. This worked great until the invasion at Omaha Beach. There wasn't enough blood around with all those casualties, and finally the Surgeon General said, okay, we'll give you your whole blood. It came from the United States. Another disastrous situation, war in Vietnam, large volume crystalloid resuscitation. We did use some whole blood. The blood was shipped for the United States. It was liquid cold stored whole blood, which is what we are now using in civilian medicine. It has known clotting deficiencies. I'll show you some of that. And FFP was given with every 5 to 10 units. Okay, lots of crystalloid and liquid cold stored whole blood. This is a scene from a combat clearing station in Vietnam. You'll see these hobby horses. They put the stretchers there. There's a bag of crystalloid hanging at every hobby horse. Tons of crystalloid, welcome ARDS, Da Nang Lung, and Shock Lung from all that crystalloid that dominated things. Now, what you see there in the graft is the liquid cold stored whole blood. What you see is a predicted drop in platelet count that occurs with liquid cold stored whole blood and what actually happened. It was known in the Vietnam era that the platelets were reduced in leukodepleted liquid cold stored whole blood. So now we come to the era of proper, the era of 1:1:1. We're going to use the components. We're going to use them like we use whole blood, big piles of red cells, big piles of plasma, big pile of platelets, and one little itty-bitty bag of crystalloid. We understood the crystalloid was bad, but we're still using the components. We developed massive transfusion protocols. This is my favorite guy. He runs to the blood bank, bangs on the door, gets the blood, and runs back to the patient wherever they are. And if you don't give him his whole blood, he gets pissed. So what is whole blood? Warm, fresh whole blood, transfused immediately or stored up to 8 hours at 22 degrees Celsius. Up to 8 hours of warm, fresh whole blood. It can be stored an additional 24 hours at 4 degrees Celsius. Cold whole blood is stored at 1 to 6 degrees Celsius. Liquid cold stored whole blood. It's fresh if transfused within 48 hours. Without adenosine, it can be stored 21 days. With adenosine, 35 days. If you take the components, add them together in a 1:1:1 to try to recreate whole blood, you will not get anything near whole blood because the components are stored in solutions for storage and they are diluted. And you can see there the counts, the hematocrit, the platelet count, coagulation activity, not very good. If you take the FFP, freeze it in thaw, you reduce coagulation factor function. If you look at a nice warm bag of whole blood out of a young war fighter, You get normal everything, 100% coagulation activity, correct hypothermia, correct acidosis, correct coagulopathy, resuscitate. It is ideal, no question about it. We know from theater that if you use fresh whole blood, these data show that if you use fresh whole blood versus components in theater, you are 10 times more likely to survive. 10 times, odds ratio 0.11, 10 times more likely to survive if you get whole blood. This is a beautiful, I call this the CMR, the crayon medical record. It is 100 times better than the electronic medical record. This man received 21 units of whole blood. He was an Afghan police officer. 21 US soldiers gave him their blood, but this is not what we have in civilian medicine. Okay, remember, whole blood is composed of red cells, plasma, fibrinogen, everything's in there. What is the universal donor? For red cells, it's type O. For plasma, it's AB. So what are you gonna do with whole blood? It turns out that if you use type O whole blood with low titers, there is rarely, if ever, a transfusion reaction. The question is, how do you define low titer? And I'll show you in Pittsburgh, it's less than 50. These are titers. These are anti-A and anti-B antibodies in the plasma in O blood to A and B blood. Pittsburgh defines as less than 50. The US military less than 256, we've been defining it as less than 250. This is a very important way to define this. In Pittsburgh, this has been well done and well published. They are very conservative. They use only male donors, only group O positive. It is leuko-reduced with a supposedly platelet-sparing filter, which does reduce platelet counts. It's stored at 1 to 6 degrees Celsius for up to 21 days. The anti-A and B titers are less than 50. It's stored in the ED refrigerator. They study this in male trauma patients in shock, males giving blood to males, not necessarily all patients, 27 non-group O, 17 group O, up to 2 units. They limit this to 2 units. Non-group O recipients receive 3 times as many units of RBCs. There were no adverse events related to the transfusion. They looked at various markers of hemolytic reactions. They looked at bilirubin, creatinine, several markers, no evidence of any transfusion reactions. They did a follow-up trial, 135 whole blood patients, matched the components patients. There were no differences in clinical meaningful outcomes, but you can see that most patients only got 1 or 2 units, some got 3 or 4. Again, very, very conservative. If they gave whole blood, they showed a 1-to-1 ratio. If they didn't give whole blood, they didn't get to a 1-to-1 ratio. In Portland, we started our whole blood program on July 9th. We have given 61 patients whole blood as of today of a median of 7 units. We have given up to 44 units of whole blood to a single patient, more twice as much as I've ever given a patient downrange. The whole blood is provided by the American Red Cross. It is low titer, defined as a titer less than 200. We use a mixture of Rh positive and Rh negative. We give Rh negative to females of childbearing age. It is leuko-reduced with a platelet-sparing filter. What a horrible mistake. Don't do it. We have a support nurse who arranges the blood bags very beautifully. Before the support nurse, it was chaos down there. You can see this is the 44-unit transfusion. There was 1 bag of crystalloid given to that patient. On top of the whole blood, we gave other components based on TEGs. I'll talk about that a little bit more. These are what you must consider when you start a program. Number one, if you use female plasma, there will be a risk of trolley. We look at the HLA antibodies from female donors to reduce this risk significantly. O negative is a rare blood type. If you have a lot of female trauma patients, this could be a problem. O negative is a rare blood type. Some people argue you can give O positive females. That is a point of debate. The number and function of the platelets, if you leuko-reduce, is a problem. It will reduce the platelet count. It will reduce function. Just do not leuko-reduce. Do not leuko-reduce. O is a universal donor. What do you do if you fill a patient with type O blood and then you say, okay, they're type A, we've given a bunch of type O, what do I give them now when you know their blood type? It doesn't matter, as long as it's low titer. Less than 50 is ideal. We store up to 14 days in CPD solution. The max of transfusion has been 44 units. If we don't use the blood, we convert it to red cells. There is no wastage. At 14 days, convert to red cells, no wastage. Stored at 4 degrees Celsius, no special storage requirement. This is elegance in simplicity. They take it out of the blood bank, they put it in a box, they bring it to you, you put it in the Belmont, it's in the patient in seconds. We call this the gangbuster problem. You can give so much whole blood so fast, you give a lot of it. The problem is, over time, there is a reduction in coagulation function. This occurs right around 14 days. Platelet function reduces at 14 days. Fibrinogen function reduces at 14 days. And this is why we convert it to red cells at 14 days. We do adjunctive therapy. As we are giving a whole blood transfusion, we're doing TEGs every 30 minutes. Based on the TEGs, we give additional components. If the TEG indicates need for plasma, we give additional plasma, platelets, additional platelets, et cetera. We are doing both of these at once, whole blood and TEG replacement simultaneously. What can we conclude from this? The most important thing, again, is stopping bleeding. Coagulopathy occurs early, and the resuscitation must address it. The best way to address it is fresh whole blood. We don't have that. The second best way is liquid cold store whole blood. And this is really, I think, this is an important lesson for me. If someone goes downrange, it's not the same product. We don't know the best way to use whole blood yet. There are questions. What should the titers be? We've had one minor transfusion reaction in our 61 patients. This patient had a titer of around 180, and we're now trying to get titers less than 50. Learn from our experience. Use titers less than 50. The next question is the Rh question. Can you give Rh positive? Everybody right now, we're still giving Rh negative females. What about the donors? What type of additional screening needs to be done? Should you use female donors, risk of trolley? Should you do HLA antibody testing, reduce that risk of trolley? And what about leukodepletion? Do not do it. The reason people leukodeplete is because there are two problems. You get minor transfusion reactions, which is basically a fever. Let them have a fever. You can get chimeras, which are two different blood types in the same patient. That is extraordinarily rare. I only know of 200 war fighters in all the time that have had this. Thank you very much, and I look forward to the panel session.
All right, thanks, Marty. Next, we're going to have Bilal Joseph up. And Bilal is a professor of surgery at the University of Arizona. He's the vice chair of research, and he's the chief of trauma. And Bilal is going to be talking to us today about factor concentrates versus plasma-based resuscitation.
Actually, there's an update in the program. I'm actually talking about Reboa. I'm just joking. So good morning. Thank you to Mary Ellen and Dr. Maddox for the invitation. Nothing to disclose.
You're out of order to change the program.
Sounds like I'm not coming back next year. All right, so if you do see Dr. Maddox come across the screen, it may or may not represent an answer to one of the questions that you have. We're gonna talk about trauma-induced coagulopathy today, talk about plasma and factor replacement. There's different factors. We're gonna kind of go over all of them a little bit, mostly focus on prothrombin complex concentrate, when, where, how to utilize it. You've seen this multiple times yesterday and today that, you know, that mortality from trauma patients is because of exsanguination, and we're still, science is pushing to fix this. And, you know, why do they continue to exsanguinate and die? And that's the real question. This is old data, but very clear that because when you have a trauma, you have increased coagulopathy from the injury itself, and this raises your mortality. There's a lot of reasons of how this happens and why this happens, and, you know, we've seen this over and over. Trauma, the shock itself, the resuscitation may lead to this induced coagulopathy. We know that has something to do with the glycocalyx degradation. There's a lot more basic science going toward to understanding this and how different resuscitation and medicines can actually fix this. We're not talking about today coagulopathy induced by medications. We all deal with these drugs every day. I want to be very clear, this is not what we're talking about. We're talking about the trauma-induced coagulopathy, not because of the medications. You know, long ago, this damage control resuscitation theory came up. We focused on all these factors, but the hemostatic resuscitation is not only red or yellow or whole blood. There's more to it. And this is a survey done by the Pittsburgh group that looked at 191 surgeons from multiple institutions. And really, what they looked at, they asked everyone, you know, how do you resuscitate? And what you see here is there's still a lot of differences across the country of how we do this. And there's no data on some of the factors that we use. These two papers, I try to read them at least once a year. Again, the prompt and the proper trials. Prompt showed us that early administration of blood products like plasma and platelets make a difference. The proper one-to-one-to-one resuscitation, better hemostasis, and fewer deaths to exsanguination. The next two papers you must read, this is where we're going now. Time matters, and this was the first paper by the Colorado group written in Lancet this year, or last year. 2 units of plasma, pre-hospital setting, or saline for patients in hemorrhagic shock. And they tried to, again, and this was ground transport, and what they found was they actually stopped the trial before they completed their enrollment, that there was no difference in the group that got early pre-hospital plasma near a level one center, no difference in 28-day mortality, multi-system organ failure, or even coagulation tests. At the same time that paper came out, the Pittsburgh group published in the New England Journal this paper looking at 2 units of plasma and air transport prior to arrival to the trauma center. It's the PAMPER trial. 24-hour mortality and 30-day mortality. And what they found here was there was no difference in the early mortality, but at 30 days, there was a 23% versus 33% in patients who got plasma prior to arrival to the trauma center. And you can see here again, the 30-day survival, there was a difference in the plasma group. And there were subgroups that, injuries that actually made a difference. The TBI was a huge number. If direct transport from the scene, there was a difference. Blunt injuries and then prolonged pre-hospital time made a difference if they got plasma or not. And now we're gonna talk a little bit about, you know, you heard Dr. Schreiber, every 30 minutes in Portland, you're getting a TEG. TEG-based resuscitation will change and continue to evolve how we do this. And these are, this will give us data which will help us with the type of resuscitation we go on to perform. We know TEG-based resuscitation improves survival. It gives you better information, better data. There's two other studies here looking at this goal-directed resuscitation for trauma-induced coagulopathy. And again, this is helping us better understand and resuscitate our patients with what they need rather than just shotgun approach to everything. Transaminin acid, we're just start talking about the different type of factor replacements. I am, the ATLS update encourages it early. I'm gonna stop right there. You're gonna have to wait for the debate, Dr. Schreiber and Dr. Wilson on TXA. Fibrinogen, this is the single most important factor for clot formation. We know when it becomes fibrin, it goes on to form and help develop our clots. This is where it all starts. And this paper by the USC group, Dr. Naba and his group, you know, looked at simply fibrinogen levels on presentation and looked at 24-hour and in-hospital mortality. And you can see the groups that had, reduced amount of fibrinogen on presentation actually had a higher mortality. And that, you know, this was the first signal toward what we're heading toward. And it goes on from there. And this fibrinogen is really being investigated very heavily. This is a retrospective study, 2011, where they actually looked at fibrinogen plus PCC versus FFP alone, looking at, you know, how much blood they had to give patients and the mortality. This was an Austrian group who did this. And what they found, and you'll see this in all the factor replacements, is a lot of times decreased platelet transfusion, decreased PRBC transfusions, but no difference in mortality. And that was a retrospective study. Here's another retrospective study, and I put this study here. This is a German study that looked at multi-organ failure mortality, because do these factors change the way these patients react? And what they found in this group is that the group that got fibrinogen actually had higher multi-organ failure, and again, no difference in clotting. Do they have an increased risk of VT? You'll hear this theme again a lot across. And they had no difference in long-term mortality. There was a difference in 6-hour mortality, but their 48-hour and 30-day mortality, there was no difference between the two groups. Fast forward to this 2017 Lancet paper that looked, it's called the Redick trial again, the Austria group. They looked at about 100 patients. They gave either concentrated factor concentrates, they gave fibrinogen and or PCC versus just plasma alone and resuscitation. And they looked at different things. This was more of a feasibility study to see if they could actually do the full study. And what they found was there was, in this study, again, a prospective study, decreased multi-organ failure, decreased need for massive transfusions in the patients that got factor replacement in conjunction with the resuscitation. And so where does fibrinogen sit on this? I don't think we're there. We know it as cryo. It's about 70%. I think we're heading there where it will be part of our resuscitation with the information we have. There's these studies that are going on currently across the world to kind of answer some of these questions. Factor VIII, I'm going to spend 1 or 2 slides on this. Surgical bleeding for congenital factor for people with factor VIII deficiency. This helps cross-linking and fibrin mesh and stabilization of clot. And this is kind of like, well, how do we use it? Is anyone using it? I don't think anyone's using this, but this study was published when I was making this talk, so I thought I'd just throw it in here. You know, they looked at 8 healthy volunteers. They looked, and they also looked at a rat model, and they kind of looked at coagulation profile and platelet function in patients who were treated with factor VIII. And what they found was, you know, the groups that got the factor VIII had decreased time to initiate clotting, clot propagation, increased clot strength, and increased platelet function. And how does this translate into what we want? They also found that there was neither thrombosis nor fibrin formation in the groups of the lung alveoli or in the kidneys. Because again, every time you use one of these factor replacements, everyone's asking, are you getting more clots? Are you forming PEs? Are you getting DVTs, strokes, MIs? That's really the question that everybody goes after. Which brings us to PCC, which is a four-factor concentrate, 2, 7, 9, and 10. Even three-factor PCC has four factors. It's just the dose of seven is what makes a difference between a three and a four-factor. It's been around for a while. Most of us use it for reversal of warfarin. Early on, these were the three factors in the United States, the Profil 9 and the Bubulin, and now we have Kcentra, which is a four factor. It's been around for a long time, mostly for hemophilia. We'll tell a little story here of how we got here. You know, hemophilia was the initial indication, and then it should be your standard of care for reversal of warfarin. And now it's entering into our trauma-induced coagulopathy, and I'm just going to tell a story of how we got here. It is an off-label use when you use it for a trauma-induced coagulopathy. Again, the only indication is for the hemophilia or the vitamin K antagonist reversal. It's always been FFP versus PCC. It's never been a conjunction. And I'm going to tell the story how we get from one versus the other, that maybe it's kind of a conglomerate of both. And PCC can be used more rapidly, no thawing, no blood groups, low risk for transfusion-related adverse events. It's actually more effective than FFP, can reduce your INR. We can argue later about whether INR matters or not. This study was actually 2009, not 2018, but they looked at 47 pigs. They diluted them, caused a trauma-induced coagulopathy, and then they treated them with either low-dose, high-dose FFP, PCC alone, or saline resuscitation. And this was a German study back maybe 10 years ago, and this is where the signal for this started coming out. And what did they find when they did this? And they resuscitated these pigs based on what we talked about, and you can see that FFP alone, either high-dose or low-dose FFP, did not normalize the pig's PT. But PCC itself actually returned the PT back to baseline. And then when they looked at hemostasis based on a spleen and a bone model in the same study, the time to achieve hemostasis in PCC was faster than that of FFP. And so this is where it kind of started opening up the door. And then they looked at overall blood loss in patients that were resuscitated with just PCC versus the high versus low dose plasma versus the saline. And again, the PCC group of these pigs had the lowest blood loss. At that time, we were using PCC in Arizona. This was a two-year study. We looked at orthopedic patients who came in, INR greater than 1.5. Our orthopedic surgeons wouldn't take them back to the OR unless they're corrected. And, you know, time to OR makes a difference. We looked at simply two groups. Propensity score matched them for multiple injuries. And when we looked at three-factor PCC, at that time we were using Profil 9 versus FFP alone, what we saw was that we actually had a time to correction of INR, time to surgery was improved, decreased transfusion requirements, and we didn't have an increased risk of VTEs. So what's the concern? So what, you know, with PCC, and I just want to take a sidestep here to kind of talk about this. Dr. Martin here in the front row has been working on this as well, and there's this whole idea that when you give this factor, you can actually cause this consumptive coagulopathy. You get this transient improvement in the coagulation profile, but you get depleted levels of the platelets and the fibrinogen, and you get this consumptive coagulopathy maybe in two-thirds of the three-factor versus the four-factor patients. And so why is this? When you give factor, you need fibrinogen. And so if you're giving these factors and you don't have the fibrinogen, you get into this wicked cycle, and that may lead to this consumptive coagulopathy. So that's where the theory of this whole PCC as an adjunct. It's not one or the other. It's in conjunction with. Can we use them together? And this was a nice, again, porcine model of hemorrhagic shock, 60 porcine swine that were utilized, seven groups. You can see the seven groups here where they used either the factors alone or factors in conjunction with FFP. And when you looked at the plasma plus PCC and TXA, you had increased improvement in the hypotension, increased clot formation, and decreased lactate acidosis in those pigs that were resuscitated in the plasma group with the, and so at that time we started getting into the PCC in conjunction with FFP. This was another study we looked at, again, three-factor PCC with FFP versus FFP alone. And what we found is when we resuscitated these patients not on any anticoagulants, we had improved INR time, improved a decreased amount of overall transfusions, improved mortality, and again, no difference. This study was not powered to look at mortality. And at that time, 2015, the FDA approves four-factor PCC or Kcentra. So now we get into this whole four-factor, and we're like, well, three-factor is different than four, so we got to look at this all over again. We started using four-factor PCC, and again, we were seeing the same things, decreased time to INR, correction, transfusion requirements, lower mortality, and again, no difference in VTE in the patients resuscitated in plasma alone or plasma plus factor. And then we're like, oh, you got to look at your three-factor versus four-factor. And then again, here, when we did this, you know, people say four-factor costs more, has a higher risk of seven, so that you're going to get more clots. And when we looked at this, again, one-to-one study, three-factor versus four-factor, in our trauma cohort, again, we saw the only difference is actually four-factor improved time to INR correction, reduced the transfusion requirements compared to three-factor, and no difference in some of the other things there. Everyone's like, oh, this is a single-center study. You can't really use it. Selection bias. We looked at our TQIP data. Again, TQIP has 400 institutions. It's probably the best data we have and the cleanest data of institutions using this. Again, patients who were using, who were injured by trauma, getting factor plus plasma versus versus plasma alone. Again, what did we see? That when you got a four-factor PCC plus FFP, you had decreased overall transfusion rate, decrease FFP, and no difference in the platelets. And then here we go again, lower AKI, lower ARDS, and we can get into the why later and we can talk to that offline, but no difference in VTE versus the groups that got the factor versus those that did not. And then here, overall survival was improved in those groups as well. There's a lot of guidelines on what to do, and I think this is important. There's the drug-induced coagulopathy. This is what Dr. Martin coined the most important slide of the talk. You know, warfarin, it should be PCC is your first-line therapy for reversal. 10A inhibitors, we're getting into the new Adnexa as the new drug coming, but PCC is still standard for it, or maybe not even have to do anything. The direct thrombin inhibitors, Praxibind or PCC again for reversal. The Europeans have guidelines on this, and I'm going to focus down just on the green here. When you look at trauma-induced coagulopathy where the fibrinogen is normal, they actually recommend PCC for reversal of your coagulopathy, and you can see also the treatment of fibrinogen when it's lower than 150. Here in the U.S., the American College of Surgeons Committee on Trauma Guidelines, you can see here that PCC is only recommended for the reversal of trauma-induced coagulopathy. At the University of Arizona, we utilize it for intra-op ongoing clinical bleeding based on Rotem, and if we have a deranged INR with clinical bleeding or MTP activation. There's studies coming looking at this. Dr. Schreiber is doing a study just for PCC in the pre-hospital setting. We're looking at a randomized trial for MTP use with and without factor replacement. Thank you so much.
Next, we're going to have Andrew Bernard up, and Andrew is a professor of surgery at the University of Kentucky and the chair of trauma surgery, and he's going to be talking to us about non-op management, and the title is it time to rein in non-operative management in kids and adults? Andrew,
well, thank you. It's great to be back here at what I consider the most clinically intense and rich trauma meeting in the world, so thank you very much. Is it time to rein in non-operative management in adults and children? I don't have any conflicts to disclose. Here's what we'll talk about. Solid organ injury in children and solid organ injury in adults. We'll talk about angio specifically as an adjunct, specifically the downsides of that. And I'll finish with non-operative management of penetrating trauma. Solid organ injury management in children is a little bit more nuanced than in the adult. One reason is because hypotension in children is head injury as often as it is bleeding. So a child who has a little bit of fluid in the abdomen is hypotensive but has a head injury may need to be managed with a bit more nuance than an adult. What is clear is that ongoing bleeding must be intervened upon. Now, what intervention? That depends upon what your resources are. If angio is not an option, then your intervention is going to be surgery. After stabilization, if a child develops recurrent hypotension, that same is true. Intervention is necessary. How to use the intensive care unit in the injured child with this sort of process? Well, kids requiring transfusion or intervention should go to the ICU, but when their hematocrit is stable for a day, they can leave the ICU and they can probably go home a day after. Spleen and liver trauma, non-operative management in children, fortunately represents failure relatively early if they're gonna fail. Risk factors for failure, high injury severity score, lower coma score, higher injury grade, multiple organs injured, older age. Now, whether that's the physiology of the child or we just tend to manage the older kids more like adults, I'm not sure. For-profit hospitals are more likely to be areas where failure of non-operative management occurs, as are non-pediatric general hospitals. This figure shows failure of non-operative management of spleen and liver trauma in children. Failure rate is on the y-axis. These are failures per 10,000 patients, and across the x-axis you see time. And clearly, most patients have failed by 24. If you make it to 48, you're going to be unlikely to have a failure in a child. What about renal trauma in children? Non-operative management of renal trauma in children is almost always successful, as in adults, 80 to 100% successful, even in high-grade injuries, fours and fives. What are the risk factors for failure of non-operative management of renal trauma in children? Collecting duct system hematoma, increasing urinoma size, interpolar extravasation as opposed to polar extravasation at the periphery, widely dissociated renal fragments are going to predict failure, and anteromedial or medial lacerations, these are more often associated with vascular injury. This is a complex algorithm. I don't put it here to go through everything here, but just to highlight some points. This is from the Arizona, Texas, Oklahoma, Memphis, Arkansas Consortium, ATOMIC. This algorithm includes all the management of solid organ trauma in children, including where you admit them, how often you get hematocrits or hemoglobins, and when you send them home. What I would like you to focus on is this circle in the very bottom right that you see says failure of non-operative management. So there are three ways to get to failure of non-operative management in an injured child: re-bleeding or continued bleeding, failure to respond to transfusion, or recurrent hypotension. So those are the three manifestations of failure in children. And then you see the three management options for the child who's failing: angioembolization, surgery, or something else. The something else is intended to be an acknowledgement that there are patients who don't fit certain guidelines, but if your patient, if your injured child meets one of these criteria, you're gonna be embolizing, you're gonna be operating, or you should at least know you're off the grid there. What you're going to see is an updated algorithm that is coming from this same group. This is from David Notrica, who's a faculty member on this program. You see here 1,000 injured children with spleen or liver trauma. The stable ones are on the left, the unstable ones on the right. I'll just take you to the very bottom row, non-operative management. So this group with this algorithm was able to successfully manage stable children non-operatively 98% of the time, and successfully manage unstable children through non-operative management 80% of the time. An updated guideline is coming from them that will include even fewer hemoglobin measurements in some children, none, no reimaging in some children, no follow-up after 2 weeks, no NPO, not even type and screen. So a lot of progress in the management of non-operative children with solid organs. What about non-operative management of solid organ injury in adults? We can gain confidence that failure is probably not going to be associated with harm. That's the theme that I would like you to take away, even in high-grade injuries. So this figure shows 2,700 injured adults getting non-operative management of splenic injury. And you see the attempted non-operative management in the immediate splenectomy group. And in every category, those getting attempted non-operative management do better. Fewer deaths, shorter length of stay in the hospital and the ICU, less mechanical ventilation, fewer complications, fewer non-infectious complications, and fewer discharges to places other than home. Now, we must acknowledge people were getting an attempt at non-operative management here because they were probably in better shape, right? So this group did a subgroup analysis that compared patients who underwent non-operative management and then failed with a group that looked clinically similar but underwent immediate splenectomy. So using that sort of analysis, they still showed that mortality rate was lower in those who had a try at non-operative management and failed, albeit they stayed a little bit longer in the hospital. For non-operative management of renal trauma in adults, it's safe, low risk of complications, that hasn't changed. Predictors of failure, similar to children, grade, non-renal injuries, penetrating injuries to the kidney. What about geriatric patients? We've historically thought that the the renal parenchyma had less connective tissue structure to it and that maybe older patients were more likely to fail. Well, recent data from Carlos Brown's group at Austin has affirmed that concern. Failure of non-operative management in geriatric patients is higher, 6% versus 4%, but still, we can gain confidence in the fact that when they fail, they don't suffer any harm. A saying at our place is, old people can't take a joke, right? You have to be extra careful with the older folks because when they have a complication, it's disaster. But we can conclude from these data that when they fail non-operative management, even the older patients don't do worse. How about angioembolization as an adjunct to non-operative management? Well, of course, it's a part of our therapy. It's a tool that's available to us, but not every patient needs it. In children, splenic extravasation is really quite rare. And angioembolization in children should rarely be used. Liver angioembolization in children is rarely reported, case series. Renal angioembolization, interestingly, in children is valuable, particularly if it means renal salvage. In adults, you should rarely be angioing patients who have ones, two, or threes with regards to spleen injuries. Consider it in the fours and fives, of course. I think the thing to remember in angioembolization and spleen trauma is this: the least complicated patient is the non-operative patient that doesn't get an angio. If you angio them and you save a spleen, it's probably worth it, but their complication rate's gonna double. Angioembolization is not without complications. The most complicated group is the splenectomy group. If they need it, they need it. If they need it, you're likely to have a complication in most patients. Splenic abscess, we've all seen infarctions and dead spleens that are a source of pain and misery for the patients and the surgeon. Pseudocyst formation, we've seen that. Less often, vascular injury, pancreatitis, compartment syndrome. Lastly, how about non-operative management of penetrating abdominal trauma? Well, first off, why would you do this? Well, the evidence would suggest that there are fewer complications, fewer surgical site infections. If there's no surgical site, there's no surgical site infection. Fewer ileuses, fewer pneumonias, fewer hernias, VTE is less, length of stay is less. So at what risk? Well, failed non-operative management of penetrating abdominal trauma is probably gonna look worse than failed non-operative management of blunt solid organ injury. Mortality is not insignificant. What are the criteria? They have to be stable. They have to have a physical exam. So they have to have normal level of consciousness. They have to not have peritonitis. What failure rate should you expect? About 7%. Now that's less if they're injured in the back and the right upper quadrant. It's more if they're injured in the flank, and it's most if they're penetrated in their anterior abdomen. So what are your risks for failure? No CAT scan is a risk for failure. You gotta have a good quality CAT scan that you trust, and if you're worried, rescan them. Hollow viscous injury, of course, is gonna be a manifestation of failure. High-grade injuries are more likely to fail, and gunshots, more than stab wounds, are going to be likely to fail. Data from the LA County Group in children shows that this can be done. The failure rate in children, 1 out of 4. Children who are non-operatively managed with penetrating abdominal trauma are most likely to gonna have kidney injuries, less often liver injuries, least often spleen injuries. So in summary, unstable patients need hemorrhage control immediately, however you do it. Operative management is still the gold standard in the large proportion of unstable patients. Non-operative management of blunt solid organ injury in children and adults is achievable in most, even without angioembolization. Algorithms and guidelines help. Non-operative management is feasible, when feasible, is less complicated than angio, which is less complicated than open surgery. Angio, the fours and fives for the spleens, rarely 1 to 3. Angio is rarely indicated in children. Non-operative management has a role in penetrating abdominal trauma. Be careful with that. So is it time to rein in non-operative management in adults and children? No, I don't think so, but surgical judgment remains essential. Thanks very much.
For the final talk, we have Milan Sen, who is the Chief of Orthopedic Surgery and the Orthopedic Trauma Director at Jacobi. We heard a great talk from him yesterday in the disaster course. Today, he's going to be talking to us about preventing orthopedic infections. Milan. Thanks.
Thanks, Kenji. And thanks again to Dr. Maddox for inviting me. It's an honor to be here. And you know, before your eyes roll back into the back of your head, I've tried to make this a little more interesting than perhaps the title alone would suggest. So a lot of what we're going to be talking about today is this, quote, new technology that's available for us in terms of, you know, preventing and fighting infection. But as you'll see, a lot of it is not really new. A lot of it are old ideas or repurposed technology that we've adapted for today. So this is a picture from a German science fiction magazine from 1930. And it's amazing that it got this drawing of these two ladies using what appears to be FaceTime and vaping. And just like today, just like present time, they're sitting across the table from each other, completely ignoring their presence because they're focused on their phones, right? And then recently I was on a plane, I decided to watch 2001 A Space Odyssey, which I hadn't watched literally for like 30 years. And you know, they have this whole thing with the video conferencing or video phone calls, and they had the scientist talking on this thing called the NewsPad. And I was like, damn, that looks just like an iPad, right? And this movie was made in 1968. And in fact, when Samsung got sued by Apple for patent infringement, they defended it by saying they weren't copying the iPad, they were copying the NewsPad from 2001, A Space Odyssey. So it's kind of neat. These ideas are not always all that new. So we're going to talk about orthopedic infections because they're a significant problem for us, up to 50% in the setting of vascular injury. And device-related biofilm infections are a huge burden on the U.S. healthcare system. And of course, the implants that we use and the biofilm forms, the host has a lot of trouble clearing the infection and clearing the bacteria. So in order for infection to set in, there's sort of three variables that it depends on. One is the presence of bacteria, the other is the presence of inert surfaces, and the third is the viability of the host cells and tissue. And as surgeons, the one we can control the best, particularly in the acute situation, is the presence of bacteria. So the goal is to sort of minimize the bacteria while improving the host wound bed. So the objective today is to talk about how to reduce the risk of infection in orthopedic trauma and to introduce some new technologies that we can use to supplement our debridement and other things that we do. So we're going to talk about negative pressure wound therapy, antibiotic beads, ionized silver, and chitosan. And you may be thinking, like, why is this guy up here talking to us about negative pressure wound therapy? But it'll make sense in the end. These things kind of all make the room hang together. So the principles of management, when we see a patient with an injury such as an open fracture, is first to recognize the extent of the injury. And sometimes it's obvious. You know, you see these badly traumatized open tibia fractures, a lot of soft tissue damage. Sometimes less obvious. So this image here on the bottom is an open femur fracture. It's just a poke hole, so it looks like nothing. But you have to recognize that the amount of energy that has to be transmitted to the tissues to break the femur and then have it travel through all that muscle just to make that tiny little poke hole is quite significant. So underneath there's going to be a lot of muscle damage that needs to be addressed. There's going to be a lot of stripping of the periosteum and blood supply to the bone. Once we recognize this, we have to do our debridement in the operating room, and you have to continue doing the debridement until we have a nice clean wound bed. And as many of you are aware, what you see on the first day may not be what you see on day 3, 4, or 5, because as time goes on, a lot of times the tissue dies because of the poor blood supply, because venous thrombosis and congestion sets in, and because of all the damage to lymphatic drainage. And then once we've got a clean wound bed, we go and do the rest of our orthopedic stuff. Now, when it comes to limb salvage, we've got to recognize sometimes there's no point, right? So if you see the bed sheets through the limb, it's probably not salvageable. But injuries like this are the ones where, you know, the quality of our initial management and debridement and how we deal with this wound can really have an impact on this patient and save limbs. So the goals of our initial debridement are to minimize the risk of infection so we can eventually get to the point where we stabilize the bone and restore function. And to do this, we have to be very aggressive. So sometimes, you know, we sort of look at the wounds and we're like, well, that doesn't look that bad. Anything that's dead or dying needs to go because it's just going to be a nidus for infection. That means taking away all the dead skin, dead tendon, dead muscle, and dead bone. And sometimes this is hard to do. And we see this a lot when these fractures are managed initially in the community where the surgeons aren't as experienced in dealing with trauma and its complications. You have this open fracture and you've got this wound. It's very common, you need a lot of fragments. And you have all these pieces of bone that have no soft tissue attachments to them anymore. They're devitalized. And it may go against your gut to take these out because it can leave you a big hole in the bone and a big defect you have to manage, but you have to take it out because this area is colonized, the bacteria is there, and if you leave large fragments of bone like that in there without any blood supply to them, it's going to be a nidus for infection. So the goal is to reduce the amount of bacteria in the wound to a manageable level so the host defenses can clear it. And if you don't do a proper surgical debridement, you can irrigate all day long, give all the antibiotics you want. You're not going to be successful at getting rid of or preventing infection.
And this is the kind of thing that can happen. I don't know, can you play the video? So, you know, I was in clinic one day and my partner's like, hey, Milan, you gotta come check this out. And I was like, what? And sure enough, this was what's going on. So, you know, managed appropriately, stabilized, but over time, you know, things evolve, tissue dies, and now nature's taken over the debridement in this patient who came in. The only complaint was the parking, which is kind of funny, right? I mean, flies maybe, I don't know, parking. So even if you do a good debridement, you have to recognize that the limb is still at risk, right? You usually have some compromise to the blood supply. You have a catabolic state, a lot of inflammation. Every dressing change is an opportunity to introduce bacteria to the wound. You have a compromised wound bed, which is a great setup for opportunistic infections. Eventually, we're putting hardware in. You know, that's our thing. And then we risk biofilm forming. And, you know, if biofilm sets in, it's very hard to get rid of. And if chronic osteomyelitis sets in, then, you know, you could lose the leg. So some of the tools that we have at our disposal to help us with this include the negative pressure wound therapy and the antibiotic drug delivery implants. So negative pressure wound therapy, much like, you know, the idea for FaceTime, is not really a new idea. So this is the Ebers papyrus. It was found in Luxor in the pyramids, and it dates back to about 1500 BC. And in this document, they talk about things like cupping and scarification to remove dead tissue and stuff. So this cupping, of course, is a form of negative pressure wound therapy. So it goes back quite a while. And if you look at some of the hieroglyphic stuff, you'll find things that greatly resemble, you know, our later cupping tools that we used for negative pressure wound therapy with the later on in medicine. Similarly, the Greeks, you know, Hippocrates, you know, around 400 BC and Galen, second century, used a lot of cupping and this process called scarification, which is where you make a little cut in the wound, and you use the cupping to withdraw, to, you know, pull blood out of the wound, in addition to all the benefits of the actual negative pressure and improving the flow to the area. And this is documented by Herodotus, who's a great Greek historian, when he talked about scarification. And apparently this negative pressure therapy with the bleeding cured a bunch of things, you know, like nausea and vertigo and a weak stomach and all kinds of stuff. So at that time, they did believe like there was an imbalance in the humors, the yellow bile, black bile, blood, and phlegm, and the correctness and balance cures a lot of illnesses, right? It's kind of like the chiropractor rebalancing your spine and curing your asthma, you know? But negative pressure wound therapy does have some benefits. So what are the mechanisms of action of negative pressure wound therapy? Well, there's the direct effect of withdrawing fluid and tissue from the wound. There's the removal of bacteria from the wound. There's the reduction of edema, which improves blood flow, so you can deliver oxygen and nutrients to the wound and antibiotics to the wound. There's also the physical stimulation of cells. So we use this a lot to our advantage when we're doing things like bone transport, and you guys may use it a lot with things like tissue expanders. But the physical stimulation of cells created by the pressure gradient causes increase in mitosis, and we see this when we use the negative pressure wound therapy because we get so much granulation tissue formation. So it does have some benefits. Now again, it's been used in alternative medicine for a long time with the bleeding and cupping, like on the left, and the use of animal bone with the erysictative to achieve the same effect. And in extreme situations, you can get skin necrosis and things like this. And in modern times, you may have seen it used by athletes to treat injuries. So Michael Phelps had this these welts on his body during the Olympics, to treat areas of injury or overuse. And this lunatic on the left is Bryce Harper, you know, who just signed a $300 million contract. So how do we use it in our practice? Well, most commonly, we use it as a bridge to get us from the injury to the time when we can get that wound covered. So this is an example here of an open tibia fracture. You see a large soft tissue injury, bones that got a lot of stripping, it's exposed to the environment. We'll clean it up, we'll stabilize it, we'll put the negative pressure wound therapy on, and that buys us some time. So we can coordinate with the plastic surgeons and sort of, when they're available, coordinate putting in our metal around the same time they get covered, so we minimize the amount of exposure of our implants to the environment and to bacteria that could form biofilm, and then we can achieve, by coordinating with them, something like this. So we'll take it from a problematic wound, open wound like this, to one that's got good coverage and function. So the other thing is, we've noticed that with the use of negative pressure wound therapy, and there's a few studies out there to support this, that we've probably diminished the need for free tissue transfer with the use of this technology. So it's really had a dramatic impact on our lives, because in a lot of our centers, and you might be familiar with this, but sometimes the hardest person to get on board is the plastic surgeon. So diminishing the need for free flaps has really helped us a lot in terms of getting these wounds managed. Another thing that's interesting is that, certainly in animal studies, the negative pressure wound therapy decreases the amount of Pseudomonas in these wounds. Well, they looked at Pseudomonas, but it represents an opportunistic bacteria. And what they saw was that compared to wet to dry dressings, when you treat it with the sponge and negative pressure wound therapy, you had a dramatically reduced amount of bacteria under the sponge. And they didn't see this effect with Staph aureus. They saw it only with Pseudomonas. And this is kind of what it looked like. You know, on the left, you had the animal wound treated with the negative pressure wound therapy. On the right, you have it treated with wet to dry dressings, and the bacteria is labeled with this fluorescent material. But this makes sense, right? Because the Pseudomonas is an opportunistic infection. It takes advantage of a compromised host or wound bed. And what the negative pressure wound therapy may be doing is sort of evening the playing field by improving the conditions and the quality of the host wound bed, so the host systems can sort of prevent this infection from setting in. Of course, no amount of sponge and negative pressure wound therapy and stuff is going to help if you don't do a good surgical debridement. So if you've got dead tissue, it has to go. You could see in this image a lot of necrotic skin. You know there's going to be a lot of necrotic fat under there. That has to be surgically debrided. There are some complications with this therapy. So if you get that call or if you show up in the morning and they're like, hey, the machine was beeping, so we just turned it off, that's really bad. It's happened. Everyone here has had that when it happens. It's really bad. So when they've looked at this in the orthopedic wounds anyway, there's been more unplanned surgeries for debridement and a significant increase in the number of wound complications and deep infections. And interestingly, in the animal models, when they had a few machines malfunction, the amount of bacteria under the sponge increased threefold in those animals. So something else we can do is deliver antibiotics locally. So what we're trying to achieve here is mixing the antibiotics with a carrier that allows us to hit the local area with a really large dose of antibiotics that we can never achieve by giving them systemically because it would be toxic to the patient. So what we do is we mix them with a carrier like methyl methacrylate, seen here. We could put them on, we can make beads and put them on a string. We could put them into a wound. So say, for example, this was a very grossly contaminated wound and we want to come back in a few days and put some hardware in there. We may do this in the interim just to really, really deliver a high dose of antibiotics locally. It creates a little bit of an antibiotic soup to try and minimize the amount of bacteria that's left over. So why not use them together, right? You get the benefits of negative pressure wound therapy, you get the benefits of the bacteria, the antibiotics locally, and maybe if the therapy powers off, you still have antibiotics there. Well, it doesn't work that way. It actually, the negative pressure wound therapy diminishes the effect of the beads. So that idea has been a fail. And this is kind of what it looks like. The control group, on the top left, you have the control group and the use of the antibiotic bead pouch. And on the bottom right, you have the control group and the bead pouch combined with negative pressure wound therapy. And you can see a lot more bacterial growth in that situation. So some of the newer technology, again, the ionized silver and the chitosan. So ionized silver is use of these silver ions that are released in a controlled manner from these dressings and stuff that we have that we use today. Now these are the Phoenicians. The Phoenicians lived several thousand years ago and they were traders. And one of the and they lived in the area that's now, you know, Lebanon and Beirut. And one of the things they traded in was wine. And in order to keep the wine fresh, they stored them in silver containers. And then we've seen this on ships and other areas where we use silver to keep liquids fresh and keep them the bacteria from growing in them. They've used them in eye drops in children, and also we've had some form of silver dressings available for a while to manage bacteria in wounds. So this is one of the newer products that out there. It's a commercial product. It's called Acticote. And what it does is it releases the silver ions at about 70 to 100 parts per million. And it's been shown that you need about between 15 and 30 parts per million to be bactericidal. And it's very broad spectrum. They're not 100% certain about all the minutiae of how it functions, but it does seem to be act against a lot of variety of bacteria, pretty much all of them, as well as fungus, so it can be quite effective. We were curious about how it would work on biofilm when I was at UT, so we grew mature biofilm on these little discs over 5 days, and then we applied varying concentrations of this Acticote silver dressing for 24 hours, and as you can see, the amount of biofilm and the amount of live cells decreased dramatically, such that with any amount of the dressing, we reduced the volume of the biofilm down by 93.5%, and the amount of live cells decreased to 1%. So it's quite effective against biofilm. So I use it a lot in my practice when I'm dealing with potential exposure or coverage or an infection around implants. The other thing is it can be used with negative pressure wound therapy. So you can use it to sort of help increase the amount of time you can leave that dressing on. So sometimes we have a wound, we feel it's clean, we've done all the debridement, we're very happy with it, but our plastic surgeon is not available for like 5 days. So instead of having to do dressing changes and negative pressure or wound vac changes every 2 days, we can put the Acticote on there and the sponge on there, and we feel pretty comfortable leaving it in place for 5 or sometimes 6 or 7 days. So one of the newer products that's out there now is this chitosan. So it's derived from shellfish, crabs, and shrimp. And it's been shown to be a compound that, I don't know how they figured this out, but it has some properties that promote good wound healing. And what they've done now is they've mixed it with a lot of drugs that act as a drug carrier. And it's shown to be very good at controlling like elution of drugs gradually out of the material. So it could be antibiotics, could be growth factors, you know, who knows, maybe you can mix it with fibrinogen or clotting factors and pack the belly with it. Who knows? It's a kind of a new thing they're just kind of playing with right now. But the interesting thing is when you're looking at infection, they found that the sponge soaked with antibiotics or with the eluting antibiotics in it nearly completely eradicated bacteria in a large animal model compared with wet to dry dressings where they saw a 2-log increase in bacteria in the wound. And recently, they've done some studies looking at this in combination with the negative pressure wound therapy and found it to be quite effective. So again, here's one of those large animal studies comparing that antibiotic bead pouch that I showed you earlier, that same bead pouch with the negative pressure wound therapy, and then this chitosan sponge with and without the negative pressure wound therapy. And you can see good results again with the bead pouch, about 16% of the bacteria remaining. Bad results when you combine that with the negative pressure wound therapy, it decreases the effect of the bead pouch like I showed you earlier. But with the chitosan sponge, with and without the negative pressure wound therapy, the amount of bacteria in the wound decreased to 6% and 2%, so quite dramatic. So this is some new technology that's really just becoming available now that may be very, very useful for us in managing these wounds. So just to summarize, you know, infections can have a devastating effect on our orthopedic wounds, particularly around implants and hardware. Some of these newer technologies exist which can really help us control and maybe even eradicate or minimize the amount of bacteria in the wound so the host can take care of the rest. And, you know, I think as trauma surgeons, we need to sort of stay abreast of all these new developments and stuff and see how we can incorporate them into our practice. And if all else fails, you know, you still have, you know, amputation. Just be sure to, you know, greet your patient and then share a brandy with them after and everything's going to be okay, right? Thank you.
Get all the speakers to come on up, and Milan, since you're already up here, that was a great talk. There's a bunch of questions here for you.
All right.
And most of them surrounded the open fracture and just practical tips. So in 2019, what antibiotic for your standard patient open fracture should we be using? And what about the timing of an IND for these patients?
So, I mean, in terms of antibiotics, you know, we're not very sophisticated in how we approach antibiotics, to be honest. I mean, we generally give, you know, ANSEF or vancomycin for most of our wounds, and if we're really concerned about contamination, we add something like, people are going to roll their eyes, gentamicin, and then, you know, again, if there's contamination with soil and stuff, we add a penicillin or something like that. I mean, we're not very sophisticated in our algorithms for this. We're sort of our data.
Speak to the audience, not the moderator.
Got it, sir. And then in terms of the timing, you know, a lot of that's changed. It used to be we sort of had this strict rule, open fracture, get to the OR within 6 hours or 8 hours. And now our approach has changed slightly. Certainly if there's a vascular injury or if there's gross contamination of the wound, that becomes an urgent case for us. So that gets to the operating room as quickly as possible. If it's an open wound that doesn't have any gross contamination, but it's a large open wound with a lot of stripping of the periosteum, then we like to get them to the operating room within sort of an 8 to 12 hour window. And if it's just a small wound, like a little wound with not a lot of periosteal stripping or just a pocal or something like that, you know, within 24 hours is usually what we're doing.
Okay, and just a quick follow-up question on that, just because we do have a lot of surgeons that may work in rural areas where they may not have immediate access to orthopedic surgery. What can the general, or what should the general trauma surgeon do for that open fracture, if anything, before it's evaluated by an orthopedic surgeon, if there's going to be a delay?
So, I mean, in that situation, I think you don't want to necessarily go too far down the rabbit hole because you don't want to do anything that compromises the surgery that may be done by the orthopedic surgeon later on. But simple things can be done is you can remove any gross contamination from the wound that you see. You can wash out the wound. You can apply a clean dressing to the wound. You can splint the extremity to stabilize the soft tissues. Starting the antibiotics, actually, even just the regular, just the ANSEF, within the first hour of the injury, has been shown to have the greatest impact on the outcome in these patients. So just a few simple steps like that would suffice.
Okay, thank you very much. Now let's move right back up to Ali Salim. So I love the questions that came. The donut of death was mentioned at least a dozen times, and the best question was, Can you give us some tips on how to do an ED thoracotomy on the CT gantry? Clearly the best question of the day. But practically now, a couple of people asked about penetrating injuries. Is there ever a role in the unstable penetrating patient for trying to get them to CAT scan? Is this defensible with the data we have currently?
You know, I don't really think it's defensible. I think, you know, the gray area is the patient who you don't know where the injury is or where the bleeding is coming from. And those are the patients that I think you can have some nuance and sort of decide whether you want to take the risk and transport a patient to CAT scan. You sort of have to look at what the cost benefit is. For penetrating injury and you're unstable, I think you have really no leg to stand on if you are not taking that patient to the operating room.
And then, you know, the other question that came up a lot is the definition of hypotension or instability. And I don't know if you can answer this, but if you could just at least comment on what would you consider unstable for the purposes of what you discussed this morning?
You know, I think that's a great question. And I think everybody would have, even on this panel, a different answer in terms of what hemodynamically unstable is. Is it the patient who started off hypotension but then is getting massive transfusion, and as the blood is coming in, the pressure is 90, is that patient unstable? I would say yes. It's really, I think it's again, you have to use the nuance. You know, you're at the bedside. You can sort of determine how safe it is to transport someone the few feet to go to CAT scan versus taking that patient to the operating room. And I think it's the answer is, how are they responding to the resuscitation? How are they responding to their transfusion? And really, how long the distance is that you'd be traveling with the patient? You know, how long would it take to get this CT scan? And also, like, what is the yield that you're actually trying to get? You know, is this CAT scan gonna really make a difference or help you in terms of your judgment on what to do with the patient? So I think you have to sort of look at all of that. But the short answer is, of what the definition of hypotension is, I think it's basically a blood pressure probably less than 90 despite aggressive resuscitation.
All right, perfect. Joe DeBose, 2019, what are the indications for inserting a Reboa catheter? I see you danced all over that,
yeah.
And you never gave it to us, so what are the indications?
I do a mean two-step, don't I? You know, Bilal's data and some others have forced us to have some great discussions about what that means. So some of it comes back to who's unstable, who's a responder or non-responder, in other words. How long do I give? The golden hour is so important, and R. Adams Calley coined that phrase to talk about the opportunity to get the patient in the operating room for definitive hemorrhage control. We know so very little about what actually happens in terms of the dynamics of that. We know every registry will tell us, admission blood pressure, but we don't know the 20% of patients that got 500 cc's of fluid and responded, and now they don't need a Reboa. That patient doesn't need it.
But who do we put the Reboa in? What are the indications in 2019?
Yeah, so patients who are not responding to fluid to my satisfaction presently is how I utilize it in the civilian world. And it's en route to the operative theater. Now, the military environment is different, and that's why we continue to push that. I don't have 40 units of blood in a tent in Afghanistan. I have 8 for 4 casualties. So Reboa is a very different modality there. That's why it came from the military, and we're trying to extrapolate some civilian experience. I think it's still a fantastic tool. Anyone who does not respond after a liter of fluid challenge and is not actively rolling to the operative theater, I'm gonna put it for blunt mechanisms, not through your penetrating chest type of mechanisms. You need to get in and get that hemorrhage controlled open. That would be a candidate for me for Reboa.
And is there a lower age limit at which we've got to stop, and this is not a candidate to put a 7 French sheath in?
Yeah, so, you know, shock trauma, all we see, we're not a pediatric trauma center, so we see 15 and above, and most of those 15s are bigger than I am, right? It's 15-year-olds. So we don't see pediatric patients in our institution. There are some individual descriptions of utilization, but the pry time device itself, the 7 French, you have to take into account the size of that common femoral artery, because we do not want to be completely occlusive if we can avoid it.
All right, and I'm going to limit you to a 1-minute response, because this could go on forever, but so many people asked, what are your thoughts on ER physicians inserting a Reboa catheter? 1 minute, max.
Hot topic, and my short answer is Reboa is a team sport. It doesn't matter who is getting the access. It doesn't matter who is putting the balloon in and inflating it. There better be a surgeon, and emergency medicine, anesthesiology should all, to do it effectively, should all be around and incorporating themselves as a team. That's why we do it in the military, and that's why we're so effective in the military and have such great survival. So EM physicians absolutely should be trained and part of that team. And I think when we don't train people, it becomes this thing that they don't understand and know about. They don't know the complications. So they think it's just this great thing they saw a presentation on, and they're gonna slap it in and then call you not 2 hours later when there's a Reboa up. You need to educate them, you need to train them. It is a team sport, and it should be in every instance.
Joe, are you running for office?
No, absolutely not. I'd be a terrible
person. All right. Rick, let's move on to managing trauma patients with narcotics. There's actually a lot of folks here that would love to know about your thoughts on THC or cannabinoids and how they might spare narcotics.
A lot of billboards I saw coming into town.
It's not controversial at all. So
can I talk about ED physicians and doing Reboa instead? That's an easier.
There might be some cannabis involved there too.
Holy crap! No, I have zero experience whatsoever. I have fairly strong personal beliefs. I don't know. Does anyone know the answer to that about using pot in the emergency room for trauma?
There was a paper published about a month ago on this subject that actually showed that the patients who got marijuana did better than the ones who didn't. So,
Who got or took?
Took.
Okay.
Now, wait a minute. That's the patients or the doctors?
That's right. Well, thank you for that. All right. Let's move on. A couple questions you might be able to answer. Privileging required for paravertebral blocks, the ones that you showed, and other blocks for that matter, often thought of within the anesthesia domain, people would like to know what sort of privileging or credentialing requirements are there.
I anticipated that question, and maybe it's because we're naive and I didn't ask any particular privileging. Maybe it's because this is a bedside procedure that we do in the emergency room. Now, mind you, I work at a community hospital. I'm not at a university. I'm at a place. It's a level one center, but it's still Iowa Methodist. It's not a university. So we don't have some of the interdepartmental feuds maybe that occur. We didn't ask any particular permission. We saw this as simply an extension of general surgery skills. And it never came up, but I did anticipate this was going to be a question. It's a bedside procedure that's no more difficult than putting in a tunneled catheter.
Okay, perfect. Now, what about, you focused a lot on in-hospital treatment. There were a lot of questions about the discharge medications, and if you have any thoughts on how we might do that in a more rational way in 2019.
Tough thing again. I'm colored by my mother leaving the hospital and not taking a single narcotic after a thoracotomy. Try to maximize the Tylenol component, the acetaminophen component. And so it's a complete pain because you're having to write, separate prescriptions, and it's a lot for the patients to keep track of. But maximizing the non-narcotic component, and then, you know what, the talk was non-narcotics and trauma, and that's provocative, but that's not realistic, at least at my place yet. We still do use oxycodone, not in combination, and a 5-milligram tablet, and they will leave with a limited supply of that. It's become uncommon, though. It's become uncommon to have to refill that prescription, where that used to just be a common thing at 2 weeks. Everyone got refills.
All right. Thank you. Marty, could you clarify for everybody, at OHSU today, if you get injured, who gets whole blood versus component therapy, and who adjudicates or makes that decision in the trauma bay?
So whole blood is part of the massive transfusion protocol. Traditionally, when the beepers went off and it looked like a patient who might need blood, we'd had at the bedside, we had 4 units of red cells and 4 units of plasma. If that box is open and any of that is given, then the whole blood comes as part of the massive transfusion protocol automatically. So any trauma patient. Now, we have at any given time 40 units because we get 20 units a week and keep it for 2 weeks. If we're not using it on trauma patients, then we use it on other patients as well. But it automatically gets invoked with the massive transfusion protocol that anyone can call, nurse, doctor, anybody.
Okay, and just to clarify, that was another question. Can any service at OHSU outside of trauma request and be issued whole blood?
You know, as of today, no. It is, we started this, so this is a really important lesson for everybody in the room. Getting whole blood OHSU was driven by the surgeons. We drove it, and it was a long process. It took about 2 years to do it, but we drove it, and we preferentially received the whole blood. But again, if it's not being used by our service, and it looks like it's going to be converted, all of it's going to be converted to red cells, or part of it's going to be converted to red cells, then it will be used on other patients, and it has been used on other surgical patients and also GI bleeders as well.
Okay, I've got a couple more questions for you, but before you do that, who else on the panel has at their institution currently access to whole blood? Nobody else. How about in the audience? Who in the audience has access to whole blood? Just a very small smattering. Okay, interesting. Okay, Marty, so on that, one of the most common questions was, you know, we're very interested in the data that we've heard from you and from others over the last year or so, but we've all had obstacles. So how can we practically get this into our hospital? Do you have any tips for the people
in the audience? So this is a great question. This is a two-phase process. You need a supplier, and you need your hospital blood bank to be on board. Both have to be on board. Now, for all of you that use the American Red Cross, they have made a commitment. That's the largest supplier in the country. They have made a commitment to provide it to anybody who asks for it. So if you know that your hospital is an American Red Cross hospital, you then go to your blood bank and say, I know they're providing it, let's go, and get on board. But it's a two-phase process. Some of the suppliers are not supplying whole blood, and that's going to be more of a problem for you. But again, the largest supplier is American Red Cross, and by American Red Cross now supplying it, the other suppliers are feeling the pressure to do it. Two phases, supplier, your blood bank, and some hospitals like Stanford, they're the same entity, and that's easier. So you must look at your own personal situation. Find out who your supplier is, start talking to your blood bank. You've got to drive it. We drove it. We made it happen. You can do it at your place. This is not pie-in-the-sky stuff. 30 hospitals in this country right now are supplying whole blood to their patients, and that number grows daily.
All right, Marty, now the leukoreduction issue, is that an institution-based choice, or is that dictated by other federal or state regulations?
What a great question. So, you know, bottom line is it is not dictated by any federal or state regulations. However, the entity, again, American Red Cross, who supplies it, desires to do it the same for all centers that they supply whole blood to. So when we go back to them and say, we don't want to leukoreduce, we're facing a little bit of an obstacle there because they do want to do it the same for everyone, which makes it easier. But it is not regulated by the AABB, the FDA, state, or federal. It's, again, a supplier issue. That is a pure supplier issue.
Okay, one last question for you. Platelet function practically in non-leukoreduced cold stored blood that's less than 14 days old, what can we expect the platelets to do? And if we're going to be transfusing in a massive transfusion scenario without the benefit of a tag right up front, how should we be compensating for that lack of platelet function?
You know, that's just a great question. So the answer to the question is that if you leukoreduce, the filter, and this is measurable, the best work on this has been done by Norway. They experiment on their special forces guys all the time. They take blood off them and then make them run 5 miles and prove that they can run just as fast. But they do a lot of studies on the whole blood, and they've done platelet counts and tags on the whole blood right after it's been leukoreduced, and both the platelet numbers are significantly reduced, about two-thirds of the original quantity, and platelet function by measured by MA, again, reduced about by two-thirds. Those are substantial reductions, so if you're not using tags to guide your transfusion, I would automatically give platelets right up front and then with about every 6 units or so.
All right, thank you. Now, Bilal, you know, this was very interesting, a talk, and I think, you know, we've been talking about this for years now. The U.S. is very much a plasma and component blood product-based transfusion sort of country. Every time we go to any country in Europe, we come back and we're on this jazzed up, we need to do this, and yet it never happens. So let me ask you, should we, looking at all of the data that's available now, both from Europe and from North America in 2019, is this something that we really ought to consider? Or are we good, you know, doing whole blood or component therapy like Marty described earlier?
Is there a prospective randomized trial that has looked at this? That's what we have in our country? No, you can't say that. But I think that if you look at the European and you look at what's happening in the U.S., even that TQIP study we did, I was shocked to see that it was about, you know, I think half of those centers were level two centers that were in that study. But I think we need to, because the science is heading that direction. And resuscitation based on TEG, it's been around for a long time with cardiac and whatnot. And if you look at the cardiac literature right now, there was recent guidelines this past week looking at bleeding reversal, non-chemically induced bleeding reversal with PCC as a standard of care. I think it's coming.
Okay, so if that is in fact the case, then practically, how do we actually integrate that into our system? Yeah. What patients would be getting it, and for what indications? Again, non-pharmacologically induced coagulopathy.
I think if you have TEG or Rotem in your institution, it's critical that you get that data and you react to it. When whole blood is now going to add a whole nother curveball to this whole situation. But if you're doing component one-to-one-to-one, a massive transfusion patient, and this, we all have to admit, sometimes there's this clinical coagulopathy where you're standing there, you know the bleeding's controlled, and you're just watching this patient ooze right in front of you. And that's and I think, you know, we cannot go away from the surgeon's bedside gestalt or experience. And I think that's the patient where, when we initially started, that's really what it was. It was we knew there was no other option. And so I think that, you know, in massive transfusion patients where you're hitting 8, 10, 12 units in a 1-to-1-to-1, that's another area where I think when you bleed these factors as well. So I think.
Is this protocolized at the University of Arizona?
Yeah,
are you using it as a protocol?
Correct.
Okay. Now, what about the non-trauma classic upper GI bleed or lower GI bleed patient? Does the data that we have surrounding the use of PCCs apply to them specifically?
Great question. Our emergency medical physicians, as well as our GI doctors, are now using it in massive GI bleed patients as well for resuscitation.
Okay, and what about the cost analysis at the University of Arizona? This is a question that's come up over and over. You know, you've shown a couple studies where they have, you know, a dollar figure at the bottom of both columns that look very similar. Practically, how does this impact the bottom line for the blood bank?
I mean, there's no cost for life, number one. Number two, I think it's about $1,000 to $1,500 per patient. That's what the dose is, which is about three packs of FFP. And if you're saving blood and FFP transfusions downstream, I think the cost is pretty low. I think so. It's about 12. It's very, really, really, really low. And then the other thing I would tell you, it's currently a weight-based resuscitation, meaning you use, you know, 25 cc's per kg. But there's a lot of literature coming out now that you just give a standard dose of 1,500 units or 2,000 units rather than a weight-based dose.
Okay, thank you. And Andrew, a couple questions about non-operative management. For children, are there any real contraindications to non-operative management for a solid organ injury in a child? And if so, what would those be?
I think the child who is exsanguinating, you know, it goes back to my point about you must achieve hemorrhage control. So ongoing hemorrhage control, or ongoing hemorrhage that you can't fix with angioembolization, that would be it. Hard contraindication.
Okay, and what about for adults?
Same.
Okay.
It's just the kids are going to be less likely to present that clinical scenario. The adults much more common.
Okay, now, yes, Marty.
I want to ask Andrew a question. What about a kid, 5-year-old kid, handlebar injury, obvious transected pancreas, totally stable, not bleeding?
Is this the case management session? Or is
just a question.
I would say that is, so you say there's bleeding, no bleeding.
No bleeding.
Then the kid would be non-operatively managed. Well, with respect to hemorrhage control, if the kid's pancreas is in half, then you have a pancreas operation to do. Yeah.
All right.
Yes.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Thanks, Marty.
Yeah, I was speaking specifically with respect to hemorrhage. I see Marty's
okay,
point.
Okay, perfect. Now, there are a lot of questions on the indications for angioembolization in solid organ injury in both adults and in kids. And I know that it's a huge topic, but if you could give us a concise summary statement on who needs to be considered for angioembolization, adults and then kids.
Yeah, so adults are easier. The spleens that are 4s and 5s, consider. You'll talk with your radiologist. You'll look at the patient's hemodynamics and their response. The livers, the WTA guideline is really good for this. So free extravasation into the peritoneal cavity or shock, they're going to need angioembolization. The kidneys in select cases where you have significant extravasation that you don't think is going to be controlled in gyrotis fascia. The kids are just are going to be very similar but less likely to present in those clinical scenarios.
All right, so I'm going to consolidate a couple questions, a couple cases that people sent in. Follow-up imaging for any solid organ injury that was managed non-operatively in both kids and then in adults, who gets or requires or warrants follow-up imaging? What imaging do you use, and what's the optimal timing for that imaging?
Yeah, the evidence for this, unfortunately, is lacking. I showed you data that shows in the kids that is going away more and more, follow-up imaging. I used to do this routinely in high-grade liver and spleen trauma, particularly in people who wanted to return to contact sports. I would do an ultrasound on discharge, ultrasound on follow-up. There's no evidence that that's what needs to happen. I re-image primarily based upon symptoms, unless they are very high grade. So the fives and some fours I will re-image. It's basically based upon clinical presentation. If they look great, I won't re-image them.
All right, can you give us one last question, a couple tips on routine DVT prophylaxis, pharmaceutical, pharmacological, and then when can these kids get up and walking around? Is it based on the grade of injury that you're managing, their symptoms? How do you kind of work that one out?
Yeah, there is emerging evidence on this. Get them up and walk them, adults and kids. If they're gonna fail, you want them to fail in the hospital. And the DVT prophylaxis can basically be on 48 hours for sure.
All right, so we only have a minute or two left, but the last three questions in a row were the same. So I'm gonna ask Joe, pre-hospital use of Reboa. I know that it's a very difficult thing to answer in a minute or two, and that's
Marty,
all you get.
Marty, can you stab me too in the back here?
Yeah, I think Marty sent all three of those in actually, but can you comment on the use of, in the United States, civilian sector, pre-hospital Reboa?
Yeah, so military situation aside, that's different. I think contextually, it's different for me. The French and the British have shown that you can deliver resuscitative capabilities that include aortic occlusion to the curbside and have some salvage, right? In patients who otherwise would not likely have reached the curb. Their environment is different, the hospital. Their environment is different. They travel out with trained EM providers who are very facile and current with that technology, and they do it a lot. And I think anything that you're going to employ, you need to do a lot. So what proxy do we have in the US? At present, there are a few, every EMS organization is different. There are some EMS services that actually have physicians that travel to the scenes of the most acute injuries. Could they be the person to have the stuff to have the Reboa? I think theoretically, yes. So I do think it has some potential in the United States, but it has to be in the right hands. The other avenue that's been discussed, you know, we have a Raptor, there's an acronym for a group that's examining this and kind of teaching paramedics about Reboa. Not that we're empowering them to do Reboa in the field, but increasingly this becomes part of their meetings too. And I think that gateway to education teaches them what the complications are so that we don't have, I mean, I'm wearing cowboy boots right now. We don't want a lot of cowboys out on the curb or cowgirls out there doing things that they just saw at a meeting. So teaching them about the process, the complications, and how they flow into we are a continuum of care. It is a continuum from the curbside all the way to the operating room. I think we forget about that. So we're training them.
All right.
And the big thing may be actually just getting the femoral access. So if we can teach a medic to get continuous arterial access safely by a common femoral access, you've eliminated one of the great barriers to Reboa placement once they get to the hospital. That's a stretch too. But these things are being looked at, and I do think in the future some of these low-hanging fruits will have a role.
All right, thank you. And with that, we've got 60 seconds left, so I'd love to thank the panelists for an excellent session. Thank you for all your questions. I know there's lots more, so please catch them. Thank you.
I was going to do this.
Right.
Well, those guys won't necessarily take that patient. They won't necessarily take that patient.
You should have.